We added 12 new members this month. That's a big achievement. The core team is just started working with us in the last 10 days only. It's still a new team and we introduced 12 new members. So I'm going to introduce our core committee. Satish Reddy Nagila from Namidas. He's our secretary. And he's going to help me, you know, whenever I'm not here. And our treasurer Krishna Parada. He is actually taking multiple roles. He's taking hospitality role, you know, a lot of other roles. He's everywhere. I'm calling him every day 10 times. You know, thank you, Krishna. And then the membership committee, we have a lot of members interested, you know, to bring on new members. And the membership committee is a little bit big. So Ravi Lothmala from US Admissions. Srikan Kodla, Insoft. Srinivas Thadipalli, Global IT. Raju Padigala, Talent ID. Shekhar Brahmadevara, PRG Solutions. And the Member Benefits Committee is Ram Nandiala from Smart Folks. Just like his company. And member benefits also, you know, Ravi Lothmala is, you know, volunteering for that. You know, he's taking dual role, which is nice for us. And hospitality community, hospitality for venue and event committee, we have Praveen Chinta and Gopal Srinivasan. Gopal. Praveen is not here, but Gopal is here. In the speaker committee, we have Pushpan. Pushpan from CellSoft. Shashi Kanapati from Quant Systems. And again, we have Ram Nandiyal also here. Thank you for taking multiple roles. Anything for IT, sir. And the PR Media Relations, we have Vishwa Khandi. Today he is not here. But again, Krishna Parada is covering again for Vishwa Khandi. And the sponsor committee, Madhu Marid from Conch Technologies. Madhu, maybe he went to collect the checks. You know. And Manohar Kasagani from Prodigy Technologies. Manohar, coming with the checks. And then we have Startup Cube committee also this year. That's going to play a big role this year in 2017. And the first workshop in April, you know, the Startup Cube committee is going to conduct it. And we have very innovative, you know, very interesting people in it. Shiva Kalisetti from ConnectedX. And Vijay Prabhakar from ThemeSoft. Srini Dara from VSecure app. And Mahant from Margin IT. And from arbitration committee, we have Krishna Boga. He's here. Krishna Boga from eData Force. And then we have an interesting committee this year, Mergers and Acquisition Committee, M&A committee also.
Are you going to merge IT companies or anything?
Yeah. So depending on you know, how Trump treats us. Right? So M&A committee is right now Ravi Verma Gokaraju from Tech Team Solutions. I don't think he's here yet.
Come forward.
And we have a chapter advisor as Rao Telidevara. Thank you for be our advisor. He brings a lot of experience and lot of business experience and other forums experiences to us. And Sudhakar Penam is always advisor. He is a legend.
Lifetime advisor.
Lifetime advisor. Right. Yeah, thank you, Koti. Team, I'm going to announce the welcome the new members today. We have 12 new members. Let's see, who is here today. Shiva Kalasetti, Connected X.
ConnectedX focuses on providing services and solutions to all the market. We work with major OEMs like Honda and Daimler. We have mobile delivery centers. We are based out of Plano and glad to be here.
Thank you, Shiva. And then from Micro Info, Apireti is not here. And then from Kinectra, we have Prakash Madhipati. Venkat is here.
Hi, this is Venkat Apireti from Micro Info. We started in 2010. Thank you.
Thank you, Venkat. Then Prakash Madhipatla from Kinectra.
Just raise your hand so that I can come to you. Mr. Prakash is here.
No. Then Venkat Vanka from Fusion Global Solutions. Shekhar Brahmadevara from PRG Solutions. Shekhar.
In 2008, and it's an IT staffing company, like all these guys.
Thank you.
Thank you, Shekhar. And we have Mahesh Talapalli from Scintilla Soft. He's not able to come. His family going to India. He's in the airport. And Sharat Aram from Software IT Technologies. Sharat? He's not here. Yeah. Then we have Swarup Kondoro from Innovation Integration Technologies. And then Srikant Reddy Gali from Extract Inc. And then we have Rao Telidevara. He's from Catalysis. He's been associated with IT Server for a long time, but now he's our formal IT Server member.
Thank you, guys.
And then we have Silam Reddy from National Systems. Owner of this banquet hall. He's hiding somewhere.
Hi, my name is Silam Reddy. We've been in business last 20 years almost. This is our office. The next door is our office. We have a staffing company.
And the last member, Sudhakar from QData. Yeah, thank you all. And hopefully this location might work, for all the members here,
Dave, sir, sorry to interrupt you. Sir, he wants to speak.
Oh, yeah.
Hi,
we are from QData.
Hello? We are
last 5 years. We primarily provide services in infra and the data services in the technology area, and nearby also give people that area. Side. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sudhakar. And one last thing, you know, this location, we believe this is in the middle for everybody, and you know, we need your feedback. We also are going to do some survey on the locations. So, you know, all of us, you know, if we can share our, you know, location experience, then we will make sure, you know, if we are going to continue here on different places. And another thing is, you know, I need reference from all of you to add new members. Please, anytime you have new members, please text any of us. You would like to increase our member count this year, because we are adding a lot of new exciting things this year. So hopefully, you know, we can double our IT server membership this year. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dexter. And also, can we have a huge round of applause for all of our new members? Welcome to IT Serve. As well as our core Dallas committee, they're working very hard to make this possible. So one more round of applause for them. Next, we have our monthly sponsor, Online Visas. I want to say a few words about them before I introduce Sean. Online Visas is a global collaboration platform of immigration attorneys, companies, and individuals. Online Visas and Vili Law Firm proudly own a 94% approval rate on all visas. They've been in business 23 years of immigration law. Online Visas has developed a software that collaborates between companies, attorneys, individuals to produce all documents in any given visa in a fraction of time. Sean, it's all yours.
Everybody hear me okay? Hi, I'm John. It's a pleasure to be here with IT Serve. Deb invited me here. It's a really interesting time in immigration. I put out a little article that we wrote on the yet-to-be released or leaked Trump executive order. If you get a chance to read that, you might see what's happening. There's also about four bills in Congress that could really impact what you guys are doing right now. If you ever want to talk about that, I'm glad to. And we're going to have a webinar in a week or so, and we can send that out if you want to learn more about that from our perspective. And I'm really looking forward to hearing the lawyers that are here today talk about that. But I'm here as a sponsor. It's a pleasure to come down to Dallas, and we're waiting for the PowerPoint to get up, and I'll take you a little bit about what we're doing. So I'm an immigration attorney. I've been for 23 years. I've also developed a technology company about 6 months ago called Online Visas, Inc. I've actually had Online Visas as my URL since 1999, and we've actually had it to live up to its actual name, and we're going for it. Parker, do you mind to go to the next slide? All right, so our Online Visas team, this is the tech team. It's I'm the attorney, I'm the CEO. A little background about me is I'm a member of the U.S. Supreme Court. I've done three cases to the U.S. Supreme Court. I can say I actually got to argue in front of the Chief Justice that Obama appointed that will never become our Supreme Court Justice, but it was cool to do that. I have won a few, or we have won a few international awards, international business award called the Stevie for the company year in legal services based on our business model, best overall company, and the Bar Association, American Bar Association, gave us an award back in 2002. ABA called us an innovator in the legal industry when we launched Online Visas. Not a lot of people, not a lot of attorneys were online. We were one of the first to actually give away our stock and trade by giving information, and we were noted for that. I'm the immigration partner for a group called Founders Network, which is about 500 startups in Silicon Valley and around the world. We got Chaitanya, who's a member here from the Dallas area, and that's been a lot of fun to help those tech companies get through this. I've spoken at a lot of different schools and universities on immigration. I graduated law school from Oklahoma University up the road, and I went to the University of California, Berkeley. I won't bother you with the rest of our technology team, but we've got a really great team. Since launching Online Visas on May 31st, we are now in 25 countries. We have 34 law firms and hundreds of attorneys. The reason we've scaled so fast is we've actually Uberized law. We've created a software that is a way to exchange cases between different attorneys. So instead of putting offices around the world, I vet and I find really good immigration attorneys in other countries so that we use our collaboration software to move businesses and people and collaborate all around the world. Some case studies that we've done, the Oklahoma City Thunder utilized us to get a work permit for a scout in Germany. We vetted three attorneys before we found a good group to help them accompany that.
Tyson Food obtained an extraordinary ability scientist from China to open emerging markets in Asia. A UK citizen from our UK network was able to get a work permit with our Chinese law firm. And what initiated this whole thing was a case that we did with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation when we obtained a corporate, established a corporation for them and a work permit in Ethiopia. We found that to be so troubling because we have a meeting every week between about seven or eight people, two of which were in Ethiopia, to talk about where we were on the case. That's when it occurred to me is there has to be a better way to communicate with attorneys, and that's why we launched what I'll describe to you a little bit later. Veeley Law Firm is my law firm. I'm the network partner in the United States. We established in 1993. Since that time, we've done approximately 10,000 cases. There's four attorneys and 15 people on my staff. We have a 94% approval rating. We have that such high rating because we make our briefs look like magazines. This is the way that I think it's done. I think most immigration attorneys will put in a cover level, leave it up to immigration to figure out what they're doing. We think we need to litigate. I was born as a litigator, and so we've got to litigate on in paper on behalf of some really good people, including the doctor that discovered the AIDS virus, Olympians, a guy that invented a switch for Bell Laboratories, Tyson, as we talked about earlier, and Oracle's Team USA in that. We've represented all sorts of world-class clients, number of sports teams, number of ski resorts, Johns Hopkins, number of universities, including UT Arlington down here, NASA, Tyson Foods, HID Global, Bell Laboratories, numerous startups, many staffing companies, defense contractors, Broadway shows, musicians, all across the board. Here's some of the people saying what we've done. I'll let you read those on your own time, but largest action coach is the largest coaching company in the world. Of course, the Phoenix Suns and Arizona Diamondbacks, probably heard of them. We lost it. That was Grecio. What happened? Alright, so basically what it comes down, why did we invent this? Why aren't we just using one of the software packages everybody uses? Well, because they don't work very well. I've gone through five different software packages in 23 years. Immigration's difficult. There are some competitors like Visa Now that says immigration's as easy as 1, 2, 3, 4, put it in there and get it. It's the wrong way to do it. They removed the attorney from the process. We've created a software that develops the entire case through a strategy engine that drops everything from the brief to the employment letter to the notice of posting and all those sort of things. Communication has been difficult with attorneys. So we said, how can we contact every one of our clients and give them that communication? And that's what we can do. So we have a bar and a scenario that will set up what's happening in your case for each one of your cases. From 1 to 1,000 different cases you have, you'll be able to get updated daily on what's happening. Tracking and difficulty, so we put all the network all the stakeholders in there together, all the stakeholders are involved. So we have it's an online service, username, password protected. You can upload things safely and see where they are, and we have attorney support. Again, the attorneys are not eliminated from this process. We've just made it quicker and we're pinpointed on what they do. So basically here's what it's to do. Online visas, it's a portal to collaborate between the stakeholders in the immigration case. The companies can immediately initiate cases. I don't know if you've had troubles with your attorneys. Maybe it takes a little while to get them going on a case. You have a password protected area. You can start it. We'll immediately get to work. Then we have a strategy session where we go through and we identify what the problems are. We then take that information and build out your case from there. It populates all the different documents that are necessary to that. And that's where we can find the issues and we can put them into the briefs. Stakeholders can upload forms and money. You could actually pay online as quickly as buying a book on Amazon. And our document production system will duplicate a case instantaneously. We can build a case with the information in less than 5 minutes. Things that would typically take weeks.
We have 10 minutes.
Okay. So basically we talked about the lead, we talked about the strategy, and we talked about document production. These are a couple of screenshots of that. for the leads, the attorneys that are in it, we'll see where they're going. They'll click on those and go from there. Strategy is a little bit of a document up there. This shows how we can gather that information. Now, the cool thing about the strategy piece is that the reason we invented this is the way I practice law is I would take notes and I put it on a yellow piece of paper. I put it in a folder. The person that was calling me would tell me things. I'd answer them, and that's where it ended. So I said, what if we could create the concept of a legal opinion that was a collaboration? So by creating this question and answer session, when we're done with the conversation, our potential clients or our clients can go in and see what the questions were, what the answers were, maybe share it with somebody else in the firm, add some other things, upload some other things, so that we're moving back and forth throughout the case all the time. That's what that does. And then there's the document production. You can see over here the tabs. I can actually click build now on each of those things, instantaneously build those out, and then I can go up to duplicate the case and create another case that's exactly like the first case without having to go through all the process before. This does not remove the attorney from the situation. It just makes it so much quicker. It takes a lot of the paralegal problems out of it and lets us go from there. I want to turn over now to our CTO, who's going to tell us a little bit about a demo, and you can listen to this. Great video ready to show everybody that just disappears on us.
You deal with only immigration or any other?
What's that?
All your attorneys network is only immigration or specialize in immigration?
It's a really good question. So the question was, are all the attorneys in our network only in immigration? Well, we started it that way because immigration attorneys typically bill by the case and not by the hour, and we wanted to make a formula about it. Once we started that, we found other attorneys were really necessary, especially when we're bringing companies over to the U.S. and setting them up. So they wanted to have international tax attorneys. The great thing about our network is we all don't need to be in the same room, same office, or even in the same state or in the same country. So we're able to link with ancillary attorneys, such as tax, IP attorneys, other things like that have been making sense for us, and that's we have grown to that. Not our natural core, but it's easy because it's a communication thing that we can design those things in. Does anybody else have any other questions while we're waiting for our video to load up?
In which other cities are covered with your attorney? Which are the other cities you are?
Well, our network primarily is where I'm in Oklahoma, or where we're doing the majority of the U.S. things. Because we're able to chop out a lot of the cost, some attorneys in bigger cities are using us as the back end, right? So San Francisco is a really expensive place. Our staff's a lot more inexpensive than theirs. So we have some attorneys in other cities that are intaking our cases, and we're doing them back there. So we have two in San Francisco. We're in discussions with one in New York. It hasn't really been our model to put people in those places, but it's naturally kind of gone to folks looking for us to help finish their cases off. They keep the relationship, and we go from there.
How are you seeing the RFPs now?
RFPs seem to be increasing all the time. And I'd say at least 50% of our cases are getting RFPs no matter what. We've designed our briefs to answer RFPs. So, and I'd love to show you this. So when we develop out our employment letter or in our strategy session, we'll break it down to each duty of the case, how that duty lies to the degree, what percentage of the job it has. That's what the RFPs often have, right? So we'll write towards that. We know that they'll often say how many other people in your company have required a college degree before. We brief that in. We'll brief ahead of time to learn what other similar companies have required the same degree. We'll put in want ads for that. So we like to think ahead of where are they going to come from, what are the questions they have, what's their checklist. So we use RFPs and denials, and we study them to see trends, and then we'll other people's as well, to say how do we want to build these briefs to address these trends as they go forward, right? We'll look at memos. You know, if a memo comes out on staffing companies saying that the issue is who is the actual client, we've briefed a lot of cases around that issue where make sure that there's an agreement between the staffing company and the end user who has control of that client, so they're not, you're actually the employer as the staffing company. We've actually represented staffing companies under investigation where they came at that. So taking that information and knowing where those investigators are looking and building into how we build out our cases helps us to keep out of RFPs or get them approved even. So we try to think ahead, where are the trends coming, how do we brief that? So our basic concept is, don't leave it up to immigration to figure this stuff out. Try to show them, persuade them, and put it in the best possible light. And we think the brief is the key to that, and that's probably the, why we have a higher approval rating than we would have had, right? Does that make sense? Yes, we're losing it. Does anybody else have any other questions about our process, our network, what we're doing? Any concerns you have at all? Maybe while we're going, I'd like to talk a little bit. Yes, sir.
Article is really good. We can talk about.
Let's talk about that. I think everybody in this room is worried a little bit, and these guys will get into a lot more. What's going to happen in immigration? I'll give my two cents while we're doing that. So right now we have an executive order that has been out, that's been leaked. In that executive order, unlike the Muslim ban order, it doesn't say what they're going to do. What they're going to do is study, right? They want to have 90 days to study, you know, the efficiency of the H-1B. They want to see what the L-1 is. What they're looking at, and here's the question, and I would take this back to anybody that's representing you guys. You need to change the question that's being asked in this executive order. That's the important thing. The executive order is asking, what impact are visas having on American workers? That's what they're asking. What they're not asking is, what impact does making it more difficult to get a visa have on an American company? Some of the bills that are out there, the Lofgren bill, for example, who seems to be somebody who wants to support immigration as opposed to ESA, seems to be wanting to kill immigration, has some deadly pieces in it. They want to increase the prevailing wage by 150 to 200%. That is astronomical. So it's no longer, is it cheaper to have a programmer in India than it is to have in the United States? It's if I have a programmer in the United States, it's not from the United States, I have to pay this person a 200% higher prevailing wage than an American. That will make American companies leak. That will kill our economy, right? You guys are part of the strongest economy there is in the world, and the strongest economy there is in America, and it's not about bringing jobs for manufacturing anymore. That ship has sailed. Right now we have Apple, we have Microsoft, we have the leaders of this world right now. We have Silicon Valley, and nothing's like Silicon Valley. No other area in the world has that kind of creative financing, that sort of creativity and innovation combined with developers. Cities like Dallas and Boston, these are great areas for that. This can kill it. So we have to change the question, and there's some statistics out there that will help you. For every 100 H-1B STEM graduates, whether U.S. graduates or foreign graduates, it will create 44 jobs for Americans.
Hey, John, these are the jobs in Russia.
So I'll let you guys take on that. Read the article. We're going to have a webinar on that. I'll show you where to do that if you want to hear more about us. Okay, so we got our video.
You can go stand there.
Oh, take that mic. Oh, you put it in front of it.
Letters that you need for an H-1B application using the online visas gateway collaboration. Hi, I'm Ben Hunt and I'm the CTO for online visas. I'm just going to show you very quickly how easy it is to generate the required documentation, forms and letters that is to be collaboration app. So I have here a case where all the relevant information has been entered.
Matt had a video that was going to take you guys through it. I welcome anybody that wants to take us through it. Like I said, I can build a visa out in front of you in 5 minutes. Would love to show you probably a 15-minute demo of what we do, how we do it. Today was just for me to introduce myself to you. Wonderful to be here. I'd love to talk to any of you that would listen to me about any of this stuff, whether it's what I think about what's going to happen in Trump's America on immigration, or what we're doing in technology, or how we're building a network. But thank you so much for having me. I look forward to the rest of your day.
Thank you so much. It was a lovely presentation. I'm going to send across a mail to everybody, so whoever wants to contact him, they can contact him as well. And when moving forward, we would like to thank Sipal, who is our grand sponsor for the event. He's not here, so can I have a huge round of applause for him? And I would like to welcome AIS Insurance to please come forward and give their presentation.
Very great evening to everyone here, and it gives me great pleasure to be a part of this wonderful evening. And we have been associated with ITSO for almost all the wonderful meetings like this, and I think I see almost all of you every time, you know, whenever I come to the meetings. So I would just like to give you a brief introduction about AIS. I'm sure most of you know, but still, you know, I would want to go and run through what we exactly do. So about AIS, we have been serving all our clients, and in this industry we've been growing since 10 years. And we are one of the most fastest growing company, and we have a history of very successful partnership with the business, families, and insurance companies, name whatnot, and we are all with them. And also we guide and help our customers through. So basically right from process A to process Z, we make sure that we take care of each and everything that you want to know, want to see, and what you need. And also, the question of having the most, I believe everybody wants to hear that, you know, you're getting a good plan, affordable plan, something that is, you know, cost effective. I'm sure everybody wants to hear. So this is what we exactly do. We definitely do a needs assessment. We want to go through what you exactly need, and we design plans accordingly. Also, this is our core area, or I would rather say focus. So we do health and business, and in health we do employee benefits, that the group insurance, life, dental, vision, and of course supplemental. And in case of business, we deal with CGL, E&O. CGL is commercial general liability, workers' comp umbrella. So we focus in all these areas, and as you can see, AIS has grown immensely with all your support. We consider our clients as an asset. So if you can see, right, since 2005, we have grown very much, and it's all because of all of you. So we would definitely like to thank you all here. And one more note on our geographical coverage. We have been holding license over 36 states in the US, and also our majority clientele is in Texas. And we are the proud platinum sponsors for ITSO Synergy. And we are associated with ITSO, as you can see, for more than 4 years since. We have grown with ITSO, we should say. And so we would definitely like to thank ITSO as well. And we are basically specialized in IT industries, and that's how we are here. Also, we represent the top carriers. So we represent Aetna, BCBS, Cigna, Humana, Starmark. So name the carriers and we represent them. So by meaning, I would like to say that you're given a plenty of options. So we definitely don't thrust on you saying, you know what, you have one plan or you have this, you know, few plans, I would say, go ahead and choose your plan. No, we make sure we give you a couple options, go about it, and we make sure that we give you what you need. And of course, any questions that you have, you can reach out to us at any time that you need to know. And also, this is just a brief framework of what we exactly do in case of a new group. So all we need is your census, and we take that, we go ahead and send it out to all the top carriers, get the rates, and we will make sure to put that in a template that you understand very well, because it's not a layman thing, you know. So I want we make sure that everybody has to know what exactly that we are giving. So we make sure we give the right ones. You can pick what you want. So please understand that those are base rates. after which we give you the final one. So when I say rates, we are pretty sure that we can give you the most affordable plan possible. So I have seen of late that a lot of things, so during the filling of the applications, say an example, a person Y has smoked once and he takes that form that, you know, are you a smoker, non-smoker, you know, sometimes he says, you know, he wants to be very genuine and he clicks that, he takes that. And a lot of times these factors does affect your premium. So please understand that medical conditions certainly affect the premium. Of course, if you're a smoking, non-smoking, and it's just once, there's still people who are genuine and they go ahead and take it. But we make sure to scrutinize each and every application manually and actually call back and check with you. So if we think there's something that's abnormal or probably something that needs to be checked, we make sure we get back to you. So that's why we are here. So we make sure that we are with you throughout the process. And once we get those rates, you know, we negotiate with the carrier and get what you need. And also, as I spoke to you, these are the factors affecting the premiums. And we not only stop with employee benefits, we go ahead and give you dental and vision plans, and I'm sure that's very, very important. And also one attractive thing that every business right now is in case of providing good benefits for the employee, right? So that's one very attractive key to, you know, get more employees, or it's a win-win situation. So our duty is to give you the best plans possible, both for the employer and the employee. We make sure we give you the best rates and very affordable rates again. And we also offer individual and student insurance. Visitors insurance, yes, one very important insurance that, you know, that might be very useful definitely in case your parents are coming, for instance, from India. If they're coming, it's good to have a visitor's insurance. I see a lot of people, you know, trying to get insurance from their homeland. However, there are a lot of conditions, terms that needs to be, you know, applied according to wherever you're going. So we make sure we check all that and we give you that insurance, and accordingly we work on that. So I would just like to finally conclude by saying that our service just does not stop in selling the plan. It just doesn't stop there. But we make sure to continue our service to you. So whatever questions that you may have, reach out to us at any time. And the most importantly, it's not that we get back to you. We get back to you promptly. I think in this time, during, you know, this world, it's all a running world and nobody has time. All you want to hear is, you know, the whatever questions that you have, you want the answers pretty quick, right? So we are definitely good at that, trust me. So our customer service is amazing and we are 24/7 support. Any questions, anything, you can definitely get back to us. And these are some additional services that we offer. So please do contact us, and of course, call today to get a free quote. There's no harm. And a last request to all of you out there, we have given our, it's called a feedback form. It's right in that folder that we have given you with our visiting card and everything. So it would be great if you go ahead and, you know, fill that feedback form. We will have our team will be coming and grabbing those feedback forms. That would be very useful for us. And also we will send you some emails and, you know, say, hi, we are here to help you out. So we keep reminding you. Yeah. Thank you. And thank you, ID Sir, for this wonderful opportunity. Thank you so much, Ida, from AIS, our annual sponsors. And next, really quickly, I do want to recognize two more of our annual sponsors, Ace Fernandez from Brand and Insurance Full Service Business. If I could have you up here for just a few words.
And I would request everyone at the back to please maintain silence so that, you know, it's much more audible to everybody. I would request everyone at the back to please maintain silence. Thank you so much.
Hello, everybody. My name is Ace Fernandez. I'm here to represent Frampton Insurance Services. We do most of what AIS does, but we've just been doing it for a longer time. We've been doing it for over 50 years. So we look forward to your business. We specialize in IT service. Business insurance, so if you have an opportunity, we are always there to help. My number is 214 Lion King, like the movie Lion King. That's my number. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ace Fernandez. One more, I'd like to recognize Impact. We have Karthik and Vatsal here. They're also our annual sponsors. Give a huge round of applause for all of our sponsors for helping make this possible. Mm-hmm.
I'm Karthik Murliran from Impact Financial. This is Wotsal Sar. We've been sponsors for IT Cert for going on 3-4 years now. So it's amazing to see how you guys have grown. We're really proud to be a part of it. We're an independent wealth management firm based here in Dallas. We do everything from financial planning, retirement planning, and the investing as well. And so many of you achieve success on the business side. We just want to help you parlay some of that success on the retirement and personal side as well. So thank you.
Thank you so much.
We have a wonderful speaker tonight with us, so I would request Mr. Kishore Kandapatini, sir, to please come and introduce the speaker. Guys in the back, if you want to know how to get clients, be quiet. Okay? Next speaker, Susan, I've known her for about 11 years. She has a very dynamic personality. She founded an organization called the U.S. PAC, U.S. Pan-Asian American Chamber of Commerce, in Washington, D.C., over 30 years ago. I've been a member of that group for 11 years. Every year, for me, being a member is more work, but I also get rewarded. Every year, she has a conference that organizes either in Washington, D.C., New York, or California. This year is in California, May 31st to June 2nd. I've been going there for 11 years. So there she brings Fortune 500 companies, the procurement guys, the CDOs and CIOs, and puts all our members in front of them. It's like, you have to give business to my members. I was one of them. I was introduced to Allstate, was introduced to NBC Comcast, and all the other companies. So when she started US back in 1984, she was an immigration attorney. And she wanted to help immigrants from South Asian countries. At the time, back in 84, only Japanese and Chinese associations were there. They were also primarily focused on helping them individually. But she had a vision to help Asian American companies. And that's what she's been doing. I've been a member with them for 11 years. And our next conference is in California. And let's see, what else can I tell you? The biggest thing is bring the Asian American businesses in front of the corporates. Every other year, Indira Nooyi comes in for the conference and gives a keynote address, like every alternate year or so. And her membership, company size is between 1 million and 3 billion. The one new thing that she's trying is all those smaller companies that are between 10, 15, 20, 50 million dollars, she's going to the bigger companies and says, you have to give business to my members, the smaller company members. So today, I invited her. She came all the way from Washington, D.C. for this meeting to talk to us. And US PAC has several chapters, Northeast, Southeast. There's one chapter here in Dallas, and we want in West Coast as well, right? Yeah. I told her to come in today and tell us, all of our members, how to approach the CPOs, Chief Procurement Officers, CIOs, and CTOs, and how she's been opening doors for her members. So be quiet, please listen in. She's bringing in 30 years of experience to this. She took a bunch of her members to White House when George W. Bush was president and introduced to several cabinet members there. See, here's the Asian American companies, here's the IT companies, here's the staffing companies. Look at what they're contributing to the economy. So she has the power, she has the ability, she has the network and contacts to bring us to those not only big company, corporations. And this afternoon, we had a meeting with her, along with lobbying group, Satish, Mandua, and as well as some of the Dallas Core members, and we almost demanded her, it's like, what are you going to do in this very tenuous environment, political environment? What can you do to help us make sure that our H-1B program for consulting companies primarily is safe? And Satish and Susan are still talking. They're going to come up with the plan. She's going to introduce to us to senators, cabinet members in the new administration, make sure that whatever legislation that's going to come about is going to be at least cohesive and helpful to us, not only the big companies, but also IT consulting companies. She brings a lot of energy, a lot of connections, a lot of network. Without any further delay, ladies and gentlemen, Susan Allen.
Yeah,
Great. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Guys, come on up. Sit down. It's an order. From Washington, D.C. is an executive order. Come on up. Thank you, Kishore, and thank you very much, Shadid, for hosting the lunch today with your board of directors and the movers and shakers and the think tank of ITSERV. My name is Susan L. Allen. I am 100% Chinese, but I'm half South Asian. Because I grew up in Hong Kong, a British colony. I grew up with Indians. My next door neighbor were Indians. I lived just about 20 yards from the Indian temple, White Temple. I played seesaw and shared the swing with my Indian friends. My high school best friend was Ivy in a Catholic girls' school called Mary Knowles Sisters School. And she was very good in writing. And I said, Ivy, would you teach me how to write? She said, only if you come to my apartment and eat my food. And I said, you're Indian. You're curry. My mother didn't cook curry. I know Indian food. Okay, I'll go. So I went, and the curry that Ivy gave me was not the curry that my mother cooked. It gave me a small place of chutney and all these little things, and that's my introduction to real Indian cuisine. I am delighted to be here. Kishore, thank you for opening the door for me. My background is Chinese, grew up in Hong Kong, British colony, came over here after high school because I had this idea about helping people when I graduated high school, help people with disabilities. And lo and behold, I got an invitation from the White House and came to Washington, D.C. and was invited to stay. At that time, getting an immigration visa was very easy. I practically walked my paper from one office building to another and got my visa approved in 2 weeks, except that I was born in China. There was a quota, a waiting list for people born in China. I had to stay in the United States, could not leave, and waited for my visa number. But it was a breeze for me. But fast forward to today, I have had gone through law school, got my JD, got my LLM, practiced immigration law, litigated, pushed paper, fought with the government on paper. Never went to immigration court except once with a client sitting next to me and the judge was lambasting me. And I want to get up and disagree with the judge and my client said, sit down, don't get up. The judge upset. Out of respect for the client who paid me to be there, I stayed still. But after the judge, the back is yelling at me, I said, Your Honor, the facts are blah, 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 blah. And the Honor said, Counselor, I'm sorry. And I said, I accept your apology. That was the last time I went to immigration court. But I was the type of attorney who would litigate, who would dare to litigate. And the client would not pay you to litigate, right? You sue the government? No way. Folks coming from Asia, but you don't cross the government. They would not pay me, and especially when you have to ask them to pay you by the hour. Or by the hour, you're a bottomless pit. There's no end to the water that you can take from. So I tell them, if you pay the filing fee, which I cannot charge you for, I will work on your case. And if I win, there is a law called Equal Access to Justice Law, and I'll go and get that fee. So I did for three cases, litigated, waited for a long time, won the case, got two checks for six figures, and told my husband, honey, the bank, money's in the bank, I'm taking off for 2 years. But by that time, the organization was already grown, and I went into USPAC, which is the organization that I work for, and volunteered for that 2 years of sabbatical that I took from my law firm. I never returned. Why? The reason is because of people who look like you. Mostly first-generation Americans. First-generation who decided to uproot yourself, come from different countries because you have better dream for yourself and your children here. And that is why I'm here to speak to you, and I appreciate that. Now, the reason why I'm here tonight is because Kishore said that, Susan, you got all this connection. Why don't you come and talk to the folks about marketing your products and services, especially with ITSERV, it's your IT services and staffing business to the major corporations. How do you kick that door open and get our members into the door, through the doors of Fortune 1000 companies and even the federal, state, and local government? And that is what I'm here today. So if you would just listen to me, I'll tell you three major principles. If you want to be able to work with major Fortune companies, and this is from 30 years of experience. Yes, I have been with US Bank for 30 years. Just the year I got my law degree, I was asked to form this organization. Did not know anything about nonprofit organizations, but I thought, gee, it was nonprofit work that gave me the invitation from the White House to Washington, D.C. I would try it. I'm going to form this organization, and I did. And that was the opening to my door to U.S. which opened a whole new world for me. Yes, I was a lawyer. I was a damn good lawyer. My name is in the books. I still litigated. People, other lawyers, on labor certification, prevailing wage cases, Masonry and Master, that's my case. They cited my case on prevailing wages. You can't, you don't have the ability to pay, go to Susan Allen, our Allen, go Google me. But here at this forum, I want to tell you that I am for you because here in America, the Asian American community, Indian and Chinese have outpaced Mexican in immigration numbers in the United States. 45% of the immigrants in America now, in the last 5 years, have come from Asia. But we see that we are struggling sometimes, especially in IT and staffing business. And that's why I'm happy to be here to share with what I have learned in the last 30 years. It is, and I'm going to write it down because I will sometimes go off my own script. You've got to be credible, you've got to be trustworthy and sincere. You've got to do that first. Corporations have been wooed over and over again. They can see it, a con artist from 30 miles away. You got to do that. When you have credibility, that's the old first gate to a road to success. So how do we do that? As US Tech, this organization that opens door for the Asian American, the Pan-Asian American community to opportunities, we find endorsers. We find people who believe in us. Not just because they like Susan Allen. They can only do it one time. They will do me a favor for one time. I ask the second time, they may do it again. Third time, they say, wasn't it for me? But you've got to show them you're genuine, you can deliver for the goods. We did. As a result, and I mentioned some names that in your community that you recognize. Ravi Saligram. Who knows Ravi? Office Max, CEO. Rakesh Sekhar, who knows Rakesh, you know, with Sigmund Aubrey, which I just sold to, the last 2 years ago, sold to Merck for $26 million. And of course, who does not know Indra Nui? Who does not know Indra Nui? Raise a hand. Doctor. Chairman and CEO of PepsiCo. Good friend of mine, but I never ask her for favor because I do not want to compromise her by having people criticize her. Well, you do that for US Tech because you know Susan, she's Asian. No, I show her our stuff, and Indra, only when you like what we do, we deliver what you think would be good for PepsiCo and the community that you care for, do you come? She has been the chairman of our annual conference for 4 years. 4 years. She was just in Washington, D.C. 2 days ago with President Trump. So when you have folks like Indra, etc., who endorse you, by being there with you, that's your branding. And that opens door to other opportunities. And for us, the opportunity is to be open door, the door to be open to IBM, UPS, etc. And when you get in through those doors, with that tail behind you, the folks in the organization will know who you are because they know that you are credible. You got to be sincere. You got to be trustworthy when they tell you this is for you only, make sure it is for you only. So as a result of that, we have Fortune 50 companies who are our members, 1,000 companies are members, and what do they say about us? 2 nights ago, I know I was coming here, so I said, well, they want to hear me tell them how you get through the door. So they want to hear about our success, because my success could be a formula for your success. What I do is I sell my goods, and who are my goods? You, all of you. I go to them and say, you've got to use Asian Americans. They are highly educated, they work hard, the family are together. They still think that they are foreign, so therefore they have to work harder to justify they deserve to be here. So they will open the door and talk to me. So I said, why do you like us? And here's what Ingles O'Ren told me. I went to my CPO, Chief Procurement Officer, last week and said, Susan, we'd like you to come in June, in May, to her conference again. 2 days later, she said, my CPO came to my desk and said, what does she want, Susan Allen? I like her. She's real. I'll do anything she wants. Wow. And she said, I have never heard him say that. That's the Chief Procurement Officer of Ingles O'Ren. Another company, ADP, she said, you have a good reputation, the organization. And this goes to you too. So many people aspire to be big. You don't have to be big. They say you are intimate, effective, and focused. Remember that. Corporations look for vendors who have an intimate relationship because they want you to think that they are your only customer. And you focus on your work. Intimate, focused, and therefore effective. I talked to bank, Fortune 50 company bank today, this afternoon. I left the car, I said, I gotta take the call. I have to dial in. And toward the end of the call, she said, you know, Susan, I know that when we give you 25, you gave us 75. That's why we stick with you. Overperform more than what they expect. Surprise them. So as a result, we have a roster of Fortune 500 companies on our membership. And what does that mean? That translates into success stories. The company will call us and say, we want particular referrals. Myung Sena. She is a person who has her fingers on the button up when the corporation calls and says, we want 3 referrals. And she just got 3.
Yeah, they're from the inside.
Right, okay. That's right. So corporation calls and says, we want this type of vendor. And we will go into our database of our members and vet them and make sure and call them and say, are you ready for new business? We don't just refer. Because our experience has been that, let's say if I refer company A and they're busy performing on a big contract, they want new business, they forgot. And my corporation calls and they'll respond. The blame comes to me. So I spend my time with my staff. You go and vet them and make sure they're still in their business, they're not bumping something else, they also have the bandwidth. Example. So, Kishore, you have been referred to Allstate Insurance. You actually went over there for a private showing about in December?
November.
Kishore has been referred to AT&T and PepsiCo and Comcast. So, why have I done that? Because he is a company which does more than what the other company does. He also has a relationship with him. Trust him, we know that he would not let us down. If he cannot do the work, he'll tell them. Otherwise, he'll come back to us. We also work with large companies, and I hope one day these large IT companies, staffing companies, will be part of your membership, such as Calabra. Anybody know Calabra? Calabra? Artec? Anybody know Artec? Rose International? And there are more. I only mention these because these are the top of the line in the staffing business. They're with us every year, and they know what we do, and they come to us because they know that we have those relationships. Besides, we also work for the federal government. If any of you are not eyeing on the federal government, you've got to begin to look at that. Because the federal government is the largest procurer of products and services in the world. If you are not U.S. citizens, you can still do so through the GSA schedule. Anybody know about the GSA schedule? Not enough. You should do a session on that. GSA schedule. How to do business with federal government. In addition, we work with organizations such as Thai. You know Thai? Anybody know Thai? Thai? We got it all. We also know Thai. And the Asian American Hotel Owners Association. We work with them. We also work with the U.S. Hispanic Chamber of Commerce, the National Black Chamber of Commerce, because major corporations want to see us as the national leader, national organization with the history that we have had, And the reach we have with our headquarters, fully staffed in Washington, D.C., only 10 staff members, and chapters around the country, in the pressure part of our country. They would say to us that we do not have enough time nor money to fund our staff to go to all these different events. And this is something that ICC only wants to take a page from. It cannot have too many chapters, have too many, because corporations, we just don't have the bandwidth to do that, because they're also passionate about. So you want to be able to be known as the organization that brings other people together in your particular discipline. At USPEC, we are a generalist. We're a chamber of commerce, so therefore, we work with Thai IT, we work with AHOA Hotel, we work with our ARIA, Asian American Real Estate Association, and Monty Jip, which is the Chinese version of Thai, and other smaller groups, so that when there is question from corporation about who do I go to for a particular industry, we refer to them, and that has been a very effective way of working out. So, what I want to leave you with is that to get into the door of the CPO is not easy, but it's not the CPO, the CIO that you want to meet. They are the folks up there. Just like, do you want to meet the president? Can he give you a contract? No! Take a photograph, hang it on the wall, that's it. Okay? The real person is three layers behind, below. Three layers below. But you need to go meet him so that the blessing is sprinkled down. Okay? You don't have that because that's your PR, that's your branding, but you need to work with the career people. In corporation, work with people who have been in that business for a long time and watch for the retirement. Because when there is a retirement, there's new blood, and that's where you bring new relationships. Sometimes you have legacy relationship that you can bring. There's a lot more that I can tell you, but I know that you expect a lot more from me. I'll be here later, and I can answer your question, but I just want to stop this conversation with you. Let you know who we are. We're 32 years old. We're in Washington, D.C. with a full-time staff of 10. We have, I'm a fully paid president. I'm not cheap. And we have six chapters around the country, on the West Coast, in the Southwest here, in Dallas, Fort Worth, in the Southeast, in Atlanta, Georgia, in the Northeast, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Connecticut, in the Midwest, in Illinois, in the whole Midwest. And Washington, D.C. serve as the regional national capital chapter for the most affluent part of the country, the Washington metropolitan area, because the money has been flowing from Washington, D.C. No matter how poor, how tightly pressed the rest of the country is, even if California goes broke, Washington, D.C. will never be. That's why we are situated here. That's why I tell Satish, you've got to have a president in Washington, D.C. You've got to be there. You cannot just be there for one day and leave your issue with somebody else and hope that they will speak for you. You've got to be there. You have to be like sandpaper, standing every day, every now and then, give them some oil. And that's why we're there. That's why we are successful. That's why I'm where I am with USPEC. That's why people like Indra and the others endorsing us. Only in your community. Darn proud of it. I hope that I can help work with you and bring you guys in the same level as we are. Thank you very much.
Thank you, IDSERV, for giving me this opportunity. I'll just take 2 minutes of your time today. I've known some of you guys for a while, but for those of you who don't know me, my name is Ravi Thendamseri. I started an organization called Asha Jyoti USA about 8 years ago. This is to support special needs and street children in India. We also have some girl children there. And very recently, we have changed the name to Save the Child Foundation. And I'm not here to talk about the organization, but more importantly, I'm here to talk about Venila, who is the daughter of Vinay Vachakudi from IT, who's also an ITSA member. His company is Infovision. If you can bring it up. So Venila is about 13 years old, and she is taking Mount Everest Base Camp Challenge in the month of March. At her age group, an NRI kid, there's probably a very less number of children who have actually done this. And she is doing this for girl children in India. And obviously she has set a personal goal of raising about $25,000 before she gets there. And we would like to support her in any form or fashion to help enable her be the voice for a lot of girl children in India. Our projects already support children from streets, child trafficking kids, underprivileged kids, and orphan kids. So this will actually help enable us, the Save the Child Foundation, support about 5,000 children in India. One of the key asks of the ITSERV team members here is, it's twofold. I would ask every one of you to take a sheet of paper, Venila's story, which I put it on the table there. Take it and please share the story with your children back home and tell them like how a child like Venila, who's 13 years old, is going to take this Mount Everest Base Camp Challenge and be the voice of the girls. The second ask of you guys is to consider making a contribution for in support of Venila. And so this is going to be a 14-day trek. And if each of you guys contribute, say, as little as $500, we'll take your logo and we'll put it on the t-shirt. And for 14 days, we'll actually talk about 14 different problems the girl child endures, especially in India today. We do have some kids in Africa as well, but this cause primarily is going to support kids in India. And most of you are from Hyderabad and Telangana and Andhra. So a majority of these girl children would actually be from that particular area. Again, thanks for giving me this opportunity. If you guys get a chance, please visit SaveTheChild.org. That's the website, SaveTheChild.org. And please kind of make your contribution. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you so much. So now we have the most awaited event for the immigration panel. So I would like to request Mr. Rahul Reddy from Reddy and Newman to please come on the dais. Yeah. And I would like Mr. Gopi sir to please do the introduction.
Guys, well, this is the most awaited session. Executive order is still, in existence. Executive orders are working. Susan issued an order to be silent. I attended more than, probably 70, 80 monthly meetings. I never found so much silence in a monthly meeting. So they are working. Thank you, Susan. Okay. There are a lot of questions, a lot of concerns, a lot of anxiety and excitement. We are going through, very unusual time, and this kind of unusual time needs a lot of attention and focus. So we have 7-8 attorneys to, be part of the panel discussion, to address our concerns.
That's different.
CAP season is coming. Lot of RFPs, lot of 221Gs, people not able to come back from the port of entry. we are not sure what's going to happen to our business. So to address all these questions, we request we have 8 attorneys here today. I request to be Sharda Kodan. Rahul is here. Meenu Sen from Dil Setla. Grace Khan from Kerala. And
Kavita Akula from Akulala. Rajesh Patel from Patela.
I guess we'll go past.
John Willis.
I'm going to get one more chair. One more chair.
You both have to pull it together, I guess. Excuse me.
And Uma Mantravadi.
No, we're fine. I'm not sure. What? Yeah, yeah.
We have.
Okay. This one doesn't work. Only this works.
Okay. You'll do all the talking, I guess.
No, no, no. Rakesh is the host.
Oh.
Hey, good to see you. Houston.
Okay, guys. I mean, the reason executive order, protecting the nation from foreign terrorist entry into the United States. That impacted, you know, a lot of anxiety.
Rakesh is
I, you know. There are a lot of questions, a lot of concerns we are going to discuss. Sharada, I mean, this is for you. You've been attending, you know, you went to the airports recently and helping pro bono work, and, you know, you did spend a lot of hours part of ACLU. Thanks for that. And, you see a lot of cases directly, you know, first-hand information. Is it safe to travel?
Yes, it is safe to travel. Yes, it is safe to travel right now, following the recent district judge's orders. It is safe to travel. However, I do recommend to think before traveling whether it is absolutely necessary to travel. And to be prepared with all the documentation that is needed at the time of entry. Let's not have it in the check-in baggage and say, oops, I forgot, it does not work. But it is safe.
It's safe. I mean, we hear, you know, a lot of memos issued by different law firms from all over the country. They said, if you can avoid, even avoid domestic travel,
I think it's more fear in the group. The hysteria of fear is causing more anxiety than what is needed. Yes, the first week was terrible at the airport. We were there till 1 every night, trying to raise habeas corpus, writs of habeas corpus.
You have to speak more louder. Speak more louder. That's good.
So, as I was saying, the first week was pretty rough. We had to be in the airport till 1 and 2 to write writs of habeas corpus and get people out. But that was pretty much limited to the 7 countries. We saw some anomalies with other Muslim nationals.
My best friend,
but it is subsided. Right now, we have zero detainees in the airport.
Needed,
it's fine to travel as long as you're, you know.
Guys.
Use wisdom before traveling.
Back. Thanks, Sharda. Guys, please little be silent and respective of everyone in the room.
Can I add something to Sharda?
Please.
I know she was there, you know, first time, obviously. I was not. But one thing which I will tell everybody is our community especially has had difficulties, especially H-1Bs. Coming in back into the country in the last 1 year, how many cases have you heard that they checked your WhatsApp or whatnot and, you know, they were sent back because of some anomaly they found in their messages? Now everybody is talking about, oh, they're looking at your digitized media, but this has been happening to our community for the last 1 to 2 years. Nobody had a problem at that time, and now everybody has a problem. Travel still is the same risk we had last year, this year. Consulates, still the same risk. It's just as more enhanced now. That's all I think.
Yeah. I mean, but the most important thing, Kavita, is like the number of cases, what we are hearing, has increased. Let's say, you know, I mean, I know a company personally. There are like 6 people went for stamping. I mean, in a couple of countries, but everyone got the 221G. But that never happened in the history of that company.
That is what I'm saying. We had the problem, now it has been enhanced. Even though we are not a part of the seven countries, it's kind of trickling down to what has already been going on. Now it's enhanced itself, and especially the consulates, because you are bound to a second inspection at the consulate, and when you enter, you're again bound to another inspection. So at each part, we are getting scrutinized more and more. That's all I'm saying. So if anybody wants to travel for visa purposes, I would say try not to, as much as possible.
Yeah. Avoid travel.
Yeah, travel. That's my take on it.
Just a thing to add, you have to look at what's going on in the State Department. The people that were there, there have been a lot of resignations. So obviously, while there's no express memo or guidance policy out, something is happening there, right? And whether it's we want to vet out any sort of fraud, so we're going to look at applications much more closely, we're going to make sure that end clients are really end clients, we're going to make sure that, you know, these people are actually being paid. That's what I think is prompting these 221Gs. It's kind of covert, I don't think, but if you look at what's going on within the State Department, all the transitions, all the changes, there's definitely, and even in the, you know, the Attorney General's office with her being fired, I mean, you can see that there's a transition of, you know, policy right now that's going on, and that's probably what's prompting these increases in 221G. So again, like everybody said, you know, I'm advising my clients to travel only when, you know, it's really necessary, like if you have a wedding or a death in the family or something like that. But if you can avoid it, if it's just for vacation to visit, you know, the summer break or something like that, you know, you're kind of taking your chances because you don't know, like with this executive order that came out, you know, when you're traveling, something may happen. Now, do I think he's going to do this again? I think given the backlash that he's gotten from that, he may be a little bit more cautious in doing something like this, just kind of off the cuff.
Yep.
But, you know, you just he's just so unpredictable, you don't know what's going to happen.
Yep. I mean, to continue on this, you know, I mean, the 221Gs, you know, I mean, it has not started just with the executive order. I mean, we are seeing this for, like, last 6-7 weeks. I mean, probably started from December. I mean, what changed? What happened in the, you know, consulates, you know, all over, not just one consulate, you know, I mean, we have 4 or 5 consulates in India and Pakistan, Bangladesh, several other countries heard the same thing. What made this happen?
So I've thought about this a lot. We've had clients across the world that have been impacted by what we call the Trump effect. And it happened before Trump was inaugurated. It happened after he was elected. And I think the analogy is like this. If you had a new police commissioner was appointed, he was really tough on crime. The policemen that thought they could go into the hood and start beating up gangbangers would think they could get away with it. It also allows those who have a propensity to be more of a bully and demeanor to think that they're not getting in trouble or that they're actually doing the right thing. And so it wasn't as much as the president said there was a policy and people followed it, more that this was a thing. And I can tell you a couple of examples. One was we had an Argentinian skier that was going to work for Aspen. I mean, why is this a problem? And she was told that, hey, we're not going to give these visas anymore. Just a really bullying approach of, you know, we're not going to do this. Now, they let her through. But we found that we had a rugby coach who was an extraordinary ability that had to wait 3 weeks to get his visa re-adjudicated. And then we learned after the fact that there was a policy that said that they're going to re-adjudicate cases at the consulate. So getting it approved at USCIS wasn't enough. There was a whole other policy. And this whole other policy meant delays and time frames. And no one was told that that was the scenario. We had a movie star in Russia that went back for a renewal after having her extension and had a movie in America that she was going to come back for, just told not only no, but they were going to send it back to have USCIS revoke it, and during that period, there's nothing she can do. So what I've been doing, and I would ask all of you as attorneys and all of you guys, is talk to your congressman and chronicle these things and put it down. And your congressman, the staffers, will compile this stuff, and then if they have enough of these case studies, they can go back and say, this is what's happening. And I think you're exactly right. The State Department is, people are running from it. I don't know that this administration sees that as a problem. I think they see we can put our own people in. But that's the sort of thing that is happening that isn't getting a lot of press, that we're seeing on a day-to-day basis of clients that are just leaving, not just to go out and come back in on the visa they already have, but if they have to go in to get their visa renewed or stamp, then that's not the rubber stamp that it has been in the past.
Thanks, John. This is a good info. I mean, you know, the main root cause is like what you're saying is a lot of new people came into these positions in different concepts.
Right.
That's what caused it. Thank you.
And then just to add on what you're saying, and some of the things that we've been seeing, we've been discussing in our office, is that you're seeing a lot of this also comes from fear. I mean, the reality is the more that this goes on, the more that this unwritten rule or it's going on, there's more fear, which causes conversations like this, which is a good thing. It's not a bad thing. But as you said, you know, making sure that people know about your cases, making sure that your attorney, whomever it is, knows about your cases. You know, these aren't isolated incidents anymore. And the more fear that's out there, the more that this can go on. And unfortunately, whether there's an order in place or the three bills that have been put in, that have been introduced, you know, this may have to be litigated at some point. And until it's litigated, until we get to that point, which nobody knows when that's going to be, we're going to be in a situation where there's a lot of fear that's driving this. But as the advice that's being given right now, travel and, you know, domestic travel, you know, that's fear and more than it is actual policy or anything that's going on.
Thanks, Rakesh.
Yeah, I don't want to be the person to keep adding on things, but I would like to make a request for everybody who's here. The fear Rakesh is talking about is being spreading because of us, spreading because of those WhatsApp messages. If somebody has been sent back, please get the facts why they were sent back. There's something behind it. Nobody will be just sent back. Nobody will say to you on the face, oh, we have enough talent, please go back. That's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. Before you propagate, send out a message, please look at the facts of that case. Do not send it out as a request, please. Because that is scaring everybody. As I keep telling everybody, there's fear, there's concern. There's concern here. Definitely concern to be, a lot of things are going to change. But there's nothing to be feared about. And as Rakesh was pointing up, you know, it's no need to be scared, you know. And you look at the facts again.
Yep. I want to.
I have no idea. We are not thinking, we are not doing anything illegal.
I completely agree with Kavita on this. I've been given the authority to monitor the WhatsApp group of all the ITSAW members. And I've told everybody, if anybody is posting any information that doesn't belong to them, any negative information, they should check with me, and they're checking with me. Guess what? Many posts are now coming. They are allowed to come on H-1B, H-4 is being granted. There are definitely situations on the 221G that are spiked up. Nothing other than that. H-4 person has been deported from DFW airport in the Facebook. We try to track that lady. The lady says, my husband's friend's wife has been deported. And now that comes in our WhatsApp. Oh, H4 has been deported. We tried to track that lady. Nothing was... No, it's not my husband's friend. It's husband's friend. Oh, was it a DFW? No, it's actually, I think so. It's Atlanta. Really? That's true? So once we have taken the steps that we are going to monitor it, any negative information being posted, any information posted by you guys of your own situation is true. And nothing has been posted negative. Normally in Chicago, every week one guy is thrown out on H-1B, as Kavita was pointing out. We have a tracking system of that, Kavita. One person gets thrown out every week. Since the executive order, it's been 14 days, not a single buyer has been thrown out.
That's true. I agree.
Getting to the point of what Rakesh was telling on the immigration bill, the executive order, three simple words. Sue the bastards. Sue the bastards. We're going to win. We have a good chance of winning. That's what, remember, in the amicus brief submitted by Google, all top companies are there. Why are you scared about? They are doing trillions of business. They're not scared about. You are scared about it. Sue the bastards. That's the program. If ever anything goes wrong against it, we got to be ready for that.
Thanks, Rahul. The next question is like, you know, falling into the same line.
Sure, I just wanted to comment something further.
Okay.
Yeah, hi, I'm Uma Mantravadi, and I just wanted to make a comment on what Rahul and Kavita and Rakesh and everybody said. That is true. We have to be prepared, absolutely well prepared with your documentation, whether you're going in for a stamping or whether you're presenting yourself at the airport for admissibility. You need to make sure that you have all the documents. I had one client who told me that he had everything in his flash drive. And now at the airport, the officer is not going to take his flash drive and put it into a government computer to, you know, print out those documents. So please be sure that you actually carry a hard copy. Don't take it on an iPhone and say, here it is, you can take a look at it. They're not going to allow. Some officers do not appreciate that. They think it's kind of being rude to them. So the best thing is, even if you have a backup on a flash drive or on your phone or your iPad, make sure you actually have a hard copy of everything. And if you're a renewal and coming back with a stamping, ensure that you have your paychecks, your W-2s, your bank statements, because you've got to prove that you were actually maintaining your status. Having said that, I have to bring up an incident that just came up. I do a lot of O-1s and P-3s. O-1s are for movie artists who come here for the shootings. I had a Telugu film crew who applied for the visas. They were granted initially, and when they went back for the second time, because the main hero of the film couldn't make it, he had a mishap, and the whole group reapplied for the O-1, O-2s. The USCIS approved it. But when they went to the consulate, one of the female heroines of the film, who was initially granted the visa, was denied, saying that there is no proof that she's going to return back. I mean, so coming back to discretionary ways of, you know, they approved her, they even gave her the stamping the first time, but then she appeared for the second time. For whatever reasons, we are still trying to find out what that is. That why did they deny her the entry and gave it to everybody else when they initially gave it? So these are sporadic cases, but all that tells us is that it gives us a lesson to learn to say, okay, maybe this was a mistake in that particular case, maybe we can do better than that. So maybe people should give a positive feedback also, what documents somebody took, how they got the visa approved in the WhatsApp group, and Rahul, please, monitor the good ones too, along with the bad ones. But thank you so much. I just wanted to share that.
Yeah, that's good information. I want to have address this. This is a big one.
Sure.
Is J4EAD will be eliminated? It is eliminated. No.
Gopi, before you guys start with that, I just want to start with something. Sorry for intruding, I was just going through all these variety of bills of 4 or 5, and everybody wants to relate, where do we fit in? Okay. So when we talk about bill, the first point it says about, or everybody is talking about, is H-1B dependent company. So could you, we are talking about the variety of 4 or 5 bills. And the most important thing, or the significant point, what everybody is talking about, H-1B dependent. So could you just walk through us, like, because most of the people think about H-1B dependent is 50% of the staff. Either we're cutting it out or we're hiring more people. So, you know, it's easier for us to relate once you start with those points, like what exactly is the H-1B dependent. I know that we all follow on the H-1B cases, especially for the fees, but when it comes to this real-time scenario, what exactly is this H-1B dependency?
Let me answer his question first, him being moderator. H4 EAD, will they be impacted? To answer your question, just going by the leaked executive order, there's no mention of H4 EAD. It just mentions about EAD. It can be DACA EAD, it can be L2 EAD, it can be a variety of EADs we are talking about. Can it impact H4 EADs? Yes, it can, because it mentions about EAD. Now, the executive order doesn't say that we're going to take away the EADs. It says that give us a report, a recommendation of how many EADs are granted every year, and how are these EADs impacting our U.S. employees. As long as they're not impacting the U.S. employees, we don't even have any recommendation yet. The Department of State, Department of Labor are given 18 months to give a report. The initial report is going to come in 9 months, and a not final, I would say, an elaborated version is going to come in 18 months. So there is not going to be an immediate impact on H4 EADs. There is no mention of H4. There is definitely a mention of EAD. And we'll find out once the recommendation and report goes to the Senate, once they have everything laid out. I don't see that happening in another 2 years. So this is how I'm going to answer your question. Can it impact? Yes. Am I sure? No, I'm not. I'll give it to Grace to add it to it.
I just have one thing to add. The H4 EED, when they came out, you know, I think it's Save Jobs USA did file a lawsuit against it, and the litigation is pending. How the Attorney General is going to respond to that, whether they're going to, like, fight it and say, yes, we should have H4 EEDs, or whether they're going to just, yeah, you're right, you know, I mean, that case, depending on when, you know, they make a decision on it and how the U.S. is going to respond, will give you guys an indication of where the administration stands on those H4 EADs.
Is that part of any of the bills which are in Congress right now?
No. There's just litigation pending about whether the regulations are valid.
So if this happens, this has to happen through an executive order or the litigation?
Right.
The court order.
Right.
Okay. Or the bill is passed.
Or a bill. I mean, there's no bill.
Looking at the worst case scenario. Let's look at the worst. I mean, always we want to look at the best, right? But let's look at the worst case scenario. What if there's an executive order which suspends? It won't cancel EADs, but it could suspend an H4 EAD. Could suspend. And I am saying, it's nowhere on the books. Nothing has been said. If a worst case scenario will happen, just like this travel ban, it will get litigated.
Yeah.
There will be a stay. It's not going to be that easy. Things are not that easy for the White House. I'm not going to name any names, but for the White House, it's not going to be that easy.
I mean, the discussion is at the level that something is going to happen for the H4 EAD. And the questions being asked in so many forums and employees, so many employees are.
And I blame WhatsApp for it.
Too much hype.
I'm very specific. I'm blaming WhatsApp.
These are the questions. You know what? And then they said these are the answers.
Where is it?
They want the answers. That these are affecting.
That means are fast.
That's true.
What happened to the
existing
to what
you're
saying.
New ones are coming.
They're telling answers. Now, when I said answers, they're not
coming. For now, there's nothing to worry about. H4 EAD is not mentioned anywhere in the draft legislations. It is not mentioned in the draft leaked version of the executive order.
Yes.
Nothing has been said.
Yeah.
Even the worst scenario I've given, because of all those WhatsApp messages getting from India.
Yep.
Stop something that was a regulation. It has to go through the AAOs and figure out this thing, everything. Now, to add to it, when we talk about can they stop, one fine day, can they say, starting tomorrow, H4 EADs is not applicable, that won't work. Because there's a loss that is created, and they have to answer to that loss. Now, even if you see an executive order that talks about the illegal immigrants, the DACA, what they clarified was the DACA, when they have the EAD given to the DACA students for X amount of period, it is still going to be valid. So the same principle, if we extrapolate it, it will apply for H4 EADs and other EADs. So I think, Kavita and Chris are saying, we shouldn't panic about it right now. Let's wait to see what the administration and sessions come up.
The biggest concern is about the H1 right now, what we have to think about. If they have a job, then the H4.
I want to.
Rahul,
what is your question now?
H1B dependent.
Right. So this is in danger. This is going back to the question earlier about what about H1B dependent companies. And this, to me, I think probably affects more people in this room than anything. And it's not in the executive order. The executive order, as you said, just talks about looking at some panels. So really what I think we're going to look at is a negotiation. I think Trump wants to negotiate. And I'm guessing that.
Okay, but his question is, how does a company come under a H1B dependent company?
I know. I'm sorry, I'm getting there. Okay, so I wanted to set the table. So I think Trump wants to negotiate. The question is, who does Trump want to negotiate with? All right, so we have two things going on. So number one, we have this executive order saying, I want to have all these studies. And we want to study these things from the point of, will this impact American jobs? I said earlier, let's look at will this impact American companies. The question on the H-1B dependency is not in the executive order. It's in two bills. It's in the Loughran bill and it's in the ESA bill. I wrote on these a little bit. I'm glad to share with anybody about what these bills say and how they're dangerous. They're talking about dropping dependency down to 15%, right? That's huge, from 50, right? And they already said there's a high filing fee, and I don't think that's going to go down. They go up. But this is where the negotiation is going to come. And the negotiation, and I say why we don't know which one is, is that we have Congress saying that they are the determiners of these laws. And we have the president saying, no, I'm trying to centralize power, and I'm going to be the determiner of these laws. And so what Trump is trying to do is actually reform immigration through an executive order, which has never been done. It's usually Congress that's saying. So I think we're looking at a battle in a couple fields. Right now, Trump hadn't said where he's going, and Congress is doing something that could really hurt you. Those who are on your side and those who are against you are both talking about, in my opinion, the worst thing, about raising above prevailing wage to some arbitrary number. And that's the worst thing with immigration. We have arbitrary 65,000 H-1Bs. It's an arbitrary number. It's nothing to do with the market, right? So now we're talking about prevailing wages jumping to 150 to 200% above prevailing wage is what you'd have to pay for in a dependent company for a worker. And ESA's at 100,000, and we're looking at maybe 130,000 in the Loughran bill. That is where I think people like Susan need to come in with your help and get that changed in that debate. Get at the table when there is a negotiation, that you're not negotiating with the wrong people. And I think the scariest thing about this executive order is who is going to be making this report, who's not going to be at the table when this report is getting made. And the problem with all congressmen is they are on a, or our politicians, is they are just going to try to solve something from their perspective. If they're not talking to you, if they're not talking to immigration practitioners, and they're going to try to make a decision that's arbitrary, it could really, really adversely impact America's economy. And that's where I think the question needs to go. So these are really good questions you're saying, and I think that's what the biggest fear in this room has to do with.
This question, I'm sorry, if I may be wrong.
Let me answer that.
Sure.
Yeah, let me answer that.
Thank you.
He's asking about H-1B dependent.
This H-1B dependent law is nothing new. It's been there from past 10 plus years. Nothing new about it. The 15% rule is also nothing new. It's been there. When this bill was passed, they said that if you pay a person less than $60,000, or if the person doesn't have a master's degree, if you're paying either $60,000, or if the person has a master's degree, they don't count towards the H-1B number for the purpose of the dependency. 15% dependence is different than 50% dependence. 50% is only for paying the higher fees. 15% is if any of the employee are paying more than $60,000, they won't be counted towards the 15%. If anybody has a master's degree, they won't count towards the 15%. They don't have to have a U.S. master's, so for the purpose of the 15% rule. Now, when this bill was passed, most of the H-1Bs were not making $60,000. So most of the IT serve companies at that point of time were dependent companies. So now the question is that what does the dependent companies have to do in addition to what they normally do in the H-1Bs? They must try to recruit the U.S. workers. Now, when most of the companies were paying under $60,000 for the prevailing wage and they were a dependent company, our office has attended around 50, 60 LCA hearings. The evidence we provided to the Labor Department was what you do for the perm application. We provided them, look, this company, Signity, or whatever the company is doing a perm application. They have posted the advertisement in the Sunday newspapers. They have posted a news in the Texas Workforce Post Commission. They posted in their website. They posted all these things. Not a single Labor Department ever complained, and they were completely satisfied with the paperwork requirement. And in the history of the LCA hearing, that one, to my knowledge, Grace might correct me, but to my knowledge, was never penalized any company for that. So for you guys to fear that dependency is going to hurt your company, I know your IT serve companies, you're all in compliance. If not, we will check one-on-one. You will be in compliance, not a big deal.
So let me.
Can
now
I,
the other question is the $130,000
that Joe Loughran's bill, she has introduced 10 bills in the preceding 11 years. Zero bills. I'm sorry, Kishore is in advance, man. Zero bills so far has been passed. Zero. Even if the bill passed, it's not going to be much of a greatness.
Okay. Thanks,
Ravi.
Clarified most of the thing, but I still need a little more clarification on the H1 dependency.
Let me talk about it for a second, and then. Okay, two things we need to understand. One is who is an H-1B dependent employer and who are exempt and what are they exempt from? So if you understand these two definitions, you can understand any bill which has been proposed. First, you are an H-1B dependent employer if 15% of your workforce is H-1Bs. 15%. So as an example, if you have total number of employees is 8, you have 3 H-1Bs. And we are talking about a small company. You are an H-1B dependent. Okay? That's first. Who is exempt? Exempt meaning on the LCA, forget about the I-129. On the LCA, there are two questions everybody has to answer. Are you paying 60,000 or, as Rahul said, do you have a master's? If you are satisfying one of those criteria, you are exempt. What are you exempt from? You are exempt from making a displacement inquiry about a U.S. worker. That is what you're attesting on the LCA, that if for you to be exempt from that displacement inquiry, which becomes part of your public access orders, okay? Right now, the exempt criteria is very low. You are at 60,000 or a U.S. master's. All these bills are talking about removing the master's requirement and increasing that 60,000 bar to either 130, 100, variety, I don't care. A lot of misconception in this room. It is not the prevailing wage you have to pay an H-1B worker. It is for you to be exempt from certain paperwork. Okay? If you are a tier third, and then you place in vendor, and then from a vendor to end client, the DOL calls them as a secondary displacement of the U.S. worker. It is your job to either pick up a phone, send an email, make sure that you are not displacing a U.S. worker if you are not one of the exempt employers, okay? And that becomes the part of the public's access folder. Who checks this? Department of Labor. They are going to increase investigations. And one of the first thing they look at when you are hit with a DOL investigation is what? Public access folders. Right now, everybody doesn't have that because everybody needs either 60,000 or the master. So nobody has that piece of paper in their public access. But going forward, if one of these drafts ever becomes law, that's extra paperwork for you. For me, am I worrying about that? I am not, because you just have to do it. We don't know what the recruitment they're going to require. They might require us to do a recruitment equal to a perm. Maybe. I don't know. That procedure is not out. We are just looking at a draft wherein if you are not an exempt employer, you are required to make attestations on the recruitment and a displacement of U.S. worker. That's what it is.
Kavita, to add to that, I mean, you asked to send an email to the client and, you know, find out. But we...
Vendor.
Yeah, I mean, end client, right?
Okay.
You know, the displacement happens at the end client.
Uh-huh.
But we are already doing that for several years. I know most of the companies
do that, yes.
By sending a notice to post in the, you know, the most public place.
That's different. The LCA posting is a different part than the displacement inquiry, which has to be also a part of the path folder. So what you're talking about is the notice requirement.
Yes.
That's different.
Yep.
From actually you, what we have done when I do a lot of DOL investigations, when if somebody is paying less than $60,000, we make sure there's something called displacement inquiry in the public access folder. You could have options. It could be email, it could be phone, or it could be personal. But somebody has to attest to that fact that you did the inquiry.
That should come from the end client.
Let's say your HR, who's placing, or your recruiter.
Mm-hmm.
If, let's say, from you it's going to TCS, from TCS it's going to Bank of America. I'm just throwing out names here, okay? Your responsibility, because you are the second tier, yours is called a secondary displacement.
Okay.
So you all have to make the inquiry to TCS. And that's the current. What the DOL has let us do is what I'm trying to tell you. Okay? This might change. It could change. Whatever it is. So for me, when I tell, let's say, your company, it's going to pick up a phone, your recruiter, talk to TCS's HR or TCS, hey, is my guy displacing a U.S. worker? You have to verbally ask that question.
Okay.
That is what, when they are saying exempt, you are exempt from making that inquiry. Or making certain recruitment efforts, which again, as I said, right now they're already in place. Like Rahul said, they're all in place. The threshold is what they're trying to change.
Yep.
Okay?
If you make a verbal inquiry, make sure you make a memo and put that in the file.
Yeah.
Just wanted to add to that. If you make a phone call, of course, you know, unless you have that record, Department of Labor would not know that you did your part. When you make a phone call, make a memo. What you do is you have your letterhead and or your notebook state the date and who did you speak with and what was the content of your conversation. That you spoke to them, you were told that there was no displacement, no U.S. worker was displaced. Make sure that goes in the file for the candidate who you called for, so that you have the record for that.
So that is important to keep the track of this documentation and put it back in the public access.
And
absolutely.
And again, as I said, right now nobody is required to do that because everybody meets the 60,000. Our prevailing wages in Dallas are what, 63, 68, depending on which job. So we are not required.
What you are saying, or at least to my understanding, correct me if I'm wrong. So if somebody is paying above 60K. With master's or non-master's?
No master's.
Whatever.
That's an odd, yes.
Or no master's.
Yes.
Above 60K, then we can still maintain 50% of H1?
No, that has not. Don't, 50% of H1. Can I have the mic back?
That's the only thing, the 50%.
Yeah. 50% is only for fees. Fees. 50% is only for fees. It has nothing to do with any regulation. If you have 50 or more employees, and out of those you have 50% of L1s or H1Bs, you are required to pay the additional public law fees of $4,000. That has nothing to do with the dependent employer, nothing to do with exempt employer. It has a separate and apart. Okay, 50%, please, lot of confusion on this 50%.
Right.
For you to be a dependent employer, it is 15% of your workforce.
That's exactly what I've been telling everybody.
And lot of confusion on this.
I mean, there is confusion on everything.
Gopi, what I'm trying to say is these have been lost for a long time. There's no need to be confused about us. We are confused about what's going to happen. Why are we confused about what we have been doing for the past 10 years?
I mean, it's adding to the new things, and you know, the old things which we are forgot and we never even knew are coming back in a different format.
I guess some of them have been ignored, but as everybody says, even in criminal law, right, they say ignorance is not a defense.
It's a crime.
It's a crime.
It's not a defense, basically. You cannot, if a DO law auditor walks into your office, oh, I did not know about the secondary displacement.
Yep. Thank you, Kavita. Rakesh, this is for you.
Sure.
Okay. There is a lot of people on, you know, the STEM, OPT. A lot of college, I mean, students come from all over the world, you know, I mean, probably hundreds of thousands, right? There is so much talk on OPT and STEM. There was, you know, 2 years back, 3 years back, there was a talk to increase the STEM extension for 5 years and, you know, give the green cards directly, eliminate the H1s for the OPTs. Why we are hearing so much about, you know, I mean, eliminate the STEM completely and there is not going to be a STEM extension at all? Why this came up and, you know, what is impacting this?
From 12 months to 29 months.
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean, are you talking about the recent changes or are you talking about what the rumors are once again?
I mean, I don't know if it is part of any executive order.
Not
part of any bill.
No.
No, but this surfaced so much that, you know, extension is gone.
Well, I mean, I guess I can echo everything that's been said already here is that is nothing that is A, proposed, B, that's out there, or in any type of leaked executive order. There's just a lot of fear. I said it earlier, and I'm going to continue to say the same word. It's a lot of fear. And all we can do as IT serve and the companies who are, is follow the laws, as Kavita was saying just now, that we already have in place. Because in order to prepare for something that doesn't exist now, you're going to go crazy. You're going to absolutely go crazy because it's impossible to do that. You know, with STEM and OPT, How it's going to be changed, we don't know. Is it going to be changed? We don't know. What we do know is what recently happened, and where STEM extensions and the new regulations and the 983s that had to happen, that's what we need to be worrying about. We need to be worrying about following the regulations that have been put in place that we need, that you guys are already using. And you know, one of the things that you were saying earlier that brought to my attention and just want to say is that, you know, you have these orders that were put in place, the seven countries that were banned. That was put into place, whether it be campaign promises or not, it was put there for a reason. If these, and this is completely my opinion, anybody can disagree, if there was going to be an order put in place that all of this was going to be put out there, it would have been, in my opinion, done at this point. What I think is, what I think personally is going on is enough rumor has gotten out to force lawmakers to start putting proposals into Congress so the conversation starts, so there is something to negotiate. Remember, there are companies like Google that we were talking about earlier that can fight much larger than we can fight in this room, but that doesn't mean these voices are not heard. And so I think this is starting from a negotiating place a little bit different than what you were talking about, the seven country ban. So whether it be STEM, H-1Bs, or whatever it may be, you know, personally, I don't think anything's happening before April 1st. And so, but how you decide to run your company and make the decisions based on your H-1Bs is obviously up to you and the counsel of your attorney. Going back to this, the way it's going right now, I just don't see that anything's going to be put in place, and whether it was leaked or not. If it was going to be leaked, it's going to be put in place and then litigated. So the fear that you that everybody's operating with, you know, I want one thing that I want everybody to walk out of this room doing is breathing a little bit easier and taking a breath and then listening to all the attorneys that are telling you to do the same thing. So I'm going to go back to that same answer unless it's specifically something that's happened. But you know, the STEMs and the OPTs, I mean, I can pass that on if anybody else has.
I think.
Go ahead.
Camino, you want to add
to that? Well,
I would just say that what Rakesh, Kavita, and in fact everybody on the panel is saying, there's no law formed yet. There's just and that too is a leak of executive order. We don't even know if he's going to sign it or not. That can be a proposal, but Sessions being his attorney general, we always knew that he's in tie-edge ones, but it is just a proposal. Nothing has been finalized. Even if that has to be signed at some point, believe me, it's not going to happen in the next one month. It's my opinion, it's not going to happen in the next 365 days. It's going to take some time. If you'll read the executive order, which I really recommend you guys read, it just says, give me a report, recommendation, what's your opinion, 180 days, 90 days, 18 months. I don't know what is this fear about. I understand that the ban 221Gs has aggravated your concern, but as an attorney sitting here practicing immigration law, if it was a concern for my clients, I would have been the first one to send you an email and say, be careful. Yep. What I was careful about was, I honestly wasn't concerned about 221Gs as well. Everybody had a different opinion on travel, on 221Gs. I did not see any problem with any of my clients and their employees coming from UK, India, Pakistan. We did have a problem. And again, did my client employees get 221Gs before in Karachi? They did. But this time, they were more scared. I request you guys to read the leak of executive order. There's no mention of H-4 EADs. There's no mention of OBTs. It does say that. Let us know how is this impacting our U.S. employees, our companies, and that's pretty much it. If the recommendation says, and again, I'm very positive about it, maybe the recommendation comes out and say, well, it's not impacting the way we were worried about it. It is replacing the hardworking and bright employees. So these are the deserving candidates. It might not even impact H-1Bs, H-4s. Yep. So I'm not worried about it, and I suggest you guys that relax. I would say H-1 season is upon us. Go with full-fledged flow, and you know, keep this in mind. What if it comes in effect? Bring as many employees as you can this year, right, so that you don't have to worry about it next year. So I suggest that just take it easy, and right. I agree with all the members on the panel that you don't have to worry about it.
I think I know we've been harping the same thing over and over again. The same thing that applied to H4 EADs applies to STEM EAD cards. You know, it's just a leaked executive order. It has to go through the regulations and the regulatory bodies to take a look at it. But what we should be concerned about is making sure that the training plans are informed, the response to the DSOs are going out in time, because that is what we should be concerned about more, because that is what the focus is going to be more about than the EADs itself. The training plan and the response every 12 months. So. Yeah.
Thanks, Sharla.
I just wanted to add one more point to the STEM extension that has been coming about. As you all know, a lot of schools have lost the accreditation, at least 250 schools. So those students who are actually applying for the STEM extensions are facing problems, because the USCIS has taken an approach that if they have graduated from those schools, we've seen a lot, at least I have seen, a lot of RFPs or even denials because the schools have lost the accreditation. But of course, this is, again, it's going on a case by case. I wouldn't say it's a sweeping rule that USCIS has applied. So you would have to look into that. And sometimes we even pull students to go get another I-20 from another accredited school and then apply for the STEM extension, so that they could get the STEM extension, and that's worth. So a lot of people are applying the VAN to this accreditation, which probably happened around the same time, and assuming that the VAN had something to do with this, again, it has nothing. Maybe the regulation has become more tougher, and if employers are not providing with the training plan, they tend to get an RFE. So if I was an employer, I would make sure that you have complied with the training plan and complied with all the rules in the I-980. So just wanted to bring up the accreditation issue also.
Thanks so much. Wait, I want to move on to the next question.
I just want to announce some bad news. All panel will agree with this bad news. Sessions has been confirmed as an attorney.
I mean the following question, Rahul. You said you gave a great news. Okay? Great.
Yes.
I mean, what is going to bring the Sessions and the Trump combination to the immigration all together?
That's a political question. That's a political question.
The way that I see, are you saying, the way to stop them at this point is with Congress, right? I mean, the Republicans right now are very scared to speak out against him. With the Muslim ban, not very many Republican congressmen have spoken out about this. But at the same time, these congressmen represent their state. And for them, losing talent, losing skilled workers could have a detrimental impact to their economy, right? Irving, Texas, is an IT hotspot. If they were to get rid of that, that would impact Irving's economy significantly, right? So we need to make sure that whatever legislative proposal comes out is something that you guys can live with, right? Something like the ESA plan where, okay, maybe the exemption goes up to 100K instead of 60K. Is that workable? Out of the three of them, that's the most workable, because that just means you have to show recruitment documentation and have your attestations, right? So it's something that you already do through PERM, through your regular postings on DICE. So you have to be very active politically with your congressional representatives, and I cannot stress that enough, because in 2 years, they're up for re-election again, right? And if we vote for people similar mindset as Trump, you're gonna get the fruits of that reward, okay? So you have to be active politically. It can't just be, we're going to bemoan what's going to come out. You have options. You can vote. You can get, together with ITServe, you have political PACs. You can do something about it besides just worrying and fretting over what's to come, right? In California, those representatives, that's a very high IT corridor, right? It's at Silicon Valley. They can't afford to lose H-1B skilled workers, okay? We all can agree that there's not enough U.S. skilled talent to work on their various projects and to support their various agendas, right? So, it's kind of a falsehood. Yes, there was some bad press with, you know, Con Ed and Disney laying off people and staffing them with H-1B workers, but there's also a lot of good and benefits from having H-1B workers here. And you're going to have to engage in the political process to make sure that whatever bill passes, you guys can accept it.
Yep. I mean, it's not a one-day or two-day process.
No.
To involve political,
and it takes money, and it takes political capital. So
it takes a lot of time.
I wanted to weigh in on something that got lost because it happened in the last 3 days of the Obama administration, was a new rule that came out by DHS that gave 14 rules that were actually very positive on immigration. And I think it came right before all these EO drops. And these 14 rules, some of them may apply to you. Number one, there's a 60-day grace period now when someone leaves an H-1B job. So if you have to lay an employee off in the past, they would just be out of status, and you'd have to fly them home. Now they can stay. They can go find another job. Shatanya, who was here with me earlier, worked at Ericsson, was laid off 2 days after that thing, and he was freaking out. I said, no, you got 60 days, you can find a new job. This guy's trying to start his own company on the side, and he can stay there. In addition to that, if you have a green card or an I-140 that's been approved, you used to have to wait until your adjustment of status had been pending for 180 days. And for folks from India and China, those priority dates are so long from now that it took forever to get there, and you just lose your green card. Now, instead of it being at the adjustment of status 180 days, it's from the I-140 approval. And that can now be passed over, and they have a new form that goes with that. So there's these 14 really great rules, some of which existed before that are codified, and some new ones are out there. And if anybody wants to know what they are, I'm glad to email them to you. That some of them won't mean much to you, but others are really good. And that's been lost with all the negative immigration, that there's a couple things that are pretty good out there that just happened fairly recently.
Thank you. Thank you, John. Rakesh, to follow up that, we hear, again, you know, I mean, these are all nothing written, nothing, there are no laws has been written to, you know, work on this. But we hear a lot of companies, the big companies, like Fortune 10, Fortune 20 companies, who hire, you know, hundreds of people every month, indirectly passing the message to the their suppliers, do not submit any H-1B candidates.
Yes.
This is happening for like last 2 to 3 weeks. All of a sudden, you know, I mean, a big client of us, you know, I mean, passed a message and made a rule.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, why this is happening all of a sudden? You know, I mean, for them, it really doesn't matter.
Well, and I think it matters for them as well, because once again, the talent is funneling through staffing and is ending up there. So there's once again, this keeps coming back to me, and I don't know why, but the fear. and I'm going to keep using that word, but the fear of the possibility of these things going on. So the internal decisions at these larger corporations, which I'm not privy to, and I mean, some people in the room may be. You know, they're making decisions based on what they think may happen or their advisors are telling them. And it could be the same reasons and things that we're hearing now. And so as to why they're doing it, the exact reason, every company's probably got a different reason as to why they're doing it. But I don't think that's going to stop what the industry is doing, right? I'm sorry. It's going to stop what the industry is doing to move forward. So I don't think the hiring is going to stop because the economy can't stop. There's too much growth going on. So,
I'd like to add to things, obviously, you can tell. I'll tell you one. I think one of the things is the employees, you need to educate the employees not to be freaked out, because they're going and sitting in front of the client managers and talking about how their lives are at risk right now.
Yes.
You are telling to some people who are not privy to, you know, a lot of immigration matters, they will get worried. So you need to train your employees to, you know, make sure they understand, hey, nothing is going to happen. We are there, you know, we want to take care of it. So.
Yep, that's a good advice. Thanks. Moving on to the next one. Is there, in any of the bills or executive orders, is there anything to restrict the access to H-1B for the consulting company? Or, you know, I mean, to ban the H-1, to eliminate the H-1. You know, is there anything of that sort? Is
important question loud.
Can I answer that, or you want to ask somebody?
Go ahead.
Again, I mean, let me ask the same question again. I mean, there is so many rumors and, you know, so many messages being passed. Is there anywhere any of the language in the bills or the executive orders or any, you know, I mean, which are not even in the Congress, to cut the access to the H-1B for the consulting companies?
I will agree with that completely. But I mean, my opinion, and please correct me if I'm wrong, I have not seen anything which restricts or, you know, says H-1B stop, we're not going to do that. Yes, there are a lot of things which restrict the timelines or, you know, which restricts the exempt or, you know, things like that. But one thing I always told this to everybody, Trump is a businessman, okay? He is a businessman. He's not going to change that. Okay? He knows what to do, what not to do, who to worry, who not to worry. Okay? And then there was a lot of, the panel was talking about how Google is going to sue, you know, but you have to understand, all these big companies might not be dependent companies. You have to be active. These small companies, just like how Grace said, you have to be politically active. You have to make your presence felt. You do not rely on Google, you do not rely on Apple, they are not the biggest users of H-1B program. If you put their total number together versus how many H-1B, I don't even think it's 5% of their workforce. They are not H-1B dependents. It does not matter if that exempt is 130, 100. Wait. You have to make a difference for yourself.
The biggest advantage is the prevailing wages in for Google's or other things there in California.
It really doesn't matter actually. I mean, for the salary, kind of people they hire. I mean, they may not need H-1.
That's what I'm saying. You know, you have such a good idea of creating this, you know, group. Use this group. You know, be politically active. Go to your congressman. Tell what your problems are. You are taxpaying citizens. I mean, I'm assuming most of you voted, hopefully. If you have not voted, or if you still have a green card, please go become a citizen and vote and make an impact. Don't sit here and worry about things where you have a say in it. You can tell what is right, what is wrong. Yep. Just because you are 10 employer, it doesn't matter. You still have the same voice. Yep. You have to be heard. You have to go out. You have to talk to people. We cannot just sit in our community and expect magics to happen. You can tell I was a teacher before, right?
You asked a question, whether there's any possibility of this H-1 being restricted. Let me talk about...
For the consulting companies.
There was an article that came out in the Financial Express, and one of the largest Indian contributors to Donald Trump, his name is Shalabh Kumar. Shalabh, he's a businessman from Chicago, Illinois, and... I think in conjunction with his discussions with Donald Trump, the president, he came out and gave a news saying that if anything, the president is even considering taking out the overall quota for the countries so that it can open up the quotas. Like, for example, you know, the employment-based quota, not the H-1B. Right now, for each country, there is a quota, and for EB2, EB3 countries like Mexico or Guatemala, Honduras, they don't ever use them because they hardly have anybody coming on the EB2 to EB3, and that's why you see their priority date in the visa bulletin is somewhere August or October 2016. So if they eliminate that, he feels that people from India who have the EB2 pipeline can actually get the green cards much faster. So this was, I'm talking about, you know, when there's rumors, this is not a rumor, but this was actually a publication in the Financial Express. So if this does happen, it could definitely benefit India. So we cannot even individually reach out to the president. You know, maybe we should consider reaching out to his biggest donor. Also, the news is that Mr. Shalabh Kumar could be nominated as the ambassador to India, the U.S. ambassador to India. So, you know, we might use him to our benefit. That way it helps us.
Thank you, Ma.
Rahul, you want to add something?
Yeah, you asked me, is there anything in there in the pending legislation? Is everything in the proposed executive order, which is leaked and that was proposed, and that's not an executive, is there anything that ever exists and ever exists in anything? Yeah, I was, I'm from Houston, so we study NASA better. There are a lot of satellites, I mean, there's rocks that go around. You know, one of the things can strike, so I have to correct yourself that Rakesh said, until April, nothing is going to change. That rocket might, some stone might fall, and you know, you might die. So so don't live in that fear, guys. Come on.
I mean, this is you know, I mean, one executive order.
But that's
so much,
hold on.
So much
that executive order only mentioned seven countries.
Yeah.
There was, and initially, there was a confusion about the green card for those seven countries. Only two green card people that were denied entry into the country. Of course, there was a delay, and we have some nice people from Shraddha going helping them out. Only two people were being denied entry, green card holders from that particular country, from but that particular seven countries. One person has a criminal record. One person was coming after 3 years and returning back, which they are not supposed to do on the green card.
Yeah.
Only two people. In the normal circumstances, on a given day, it could have been 7 or 10, and because of the people like Shraddha helping them, it was only 2. So that's the study lesson. Yes, non-immigrant visa is waving cancer, but it is completely blown out of proportion by, I'm not a fan of Trump, I'm not a fan, but it's completely blown out of proportion by some liberal media.
Thanks, Rahul. I want to move on to the next question. You know, there are like 4 more pages of questions.
That's all.
Oh, 4 more?
This is what you get if you have 8 attorneys here.
Yeah. Yes.
You know,
sure.
You cannot have 8 attorneys and expect us not to talk.
Right. Yeah. What is the advice to the employers? You know, who are going to file the CAF cases? You know, what is your advice?
Well, my advice is do not fear. Do what you do regularly. And I would say go with the full, you know, full-fledged mode, is because if you guys fear or assume that the leak executive, for once, there's no executive order to that effect. There's only one executive order banning the Muslims from those seven countries. And again, that is, this is a very bad way to put it. Not just banning the Muslims from those seven countries. There is a detailed executive order. Leave that apart. That's not impacting any of the H-1B employers. 221Gs back home, I do not think, again, it's my personal opinion, it is not because of the executive order Trump has issued. And there's no executive order pertaining to H-1Bs, H-4 EADs, and OPT stamps. My advice to employers is look for good candidates. Make sure that they are the eligible candidates. You're not displacing U.S. employees. Send you the documents in time. Like work hard, bring them here, and do not fear. If you have any questions, call your attorneys. Instead of discussing between yourself, and again, I'm not doubting your intelligence. What I'm saying is this is a legal part of it. That's the reason you have attorneys. You have questions, shoot us an email. You have questions, give us a call. You have our phone numbers. When I say, and when we say, there is no problem, believe us. I mean, we are sitting here talking for an hour and a half. You step out and you say, I don't think I can do H-1Bs this year. It's not going to serve any purpose. Trust your attorneys. It's a very normal year. Go ahead and file your H-1s as you normally do every year. That's what my suggestion to the employers are.
Anybody wants to add?
I mean, if there's a year to file H-1s, this would be the year. Because if there's going to be any changes, it probably won't be until next year when, you know, they get through the regulatory process and Congress tries to, you know, get bills passed. So this is the year that if you guys are fearful, this is the year to file. Because if any legislation passes, it'll probably be next year. And, you know, my gut is telling me that there's probably going to be a prevailing wage increase. What it is, you know, we don't know yet for sure, but it's probably going to be higher, and you're probably going to have to do some form of recruitment. So if you want to be able to avoid all that, and, you know, if you have lower wages, this is the year to file and to ask for the full 3 years Sometimes you get it, sometimes you don't, but to document it with as much information as possible to get you those 3 years, because once you get those 3 years, that person's set. I mean, I would find it very hard for them to retroactively apply it to all cases that have been previously approved. It's usually, you know, some effective date in the future where it's going to take effect. So, you know, if you're worried, then this would be the year that you would want to file.
Just to add real quick, one of the thoughts that I have on that is that you do want to file, and I'll tell you why. Another reason is that you don't want to go into this year with fear, having the numbers reduced to, you know, from whatever it was, 200 and whatever thousand that were filed last year, to go down to 110,000, to have more reason for Congress to say there's not a need for H-1B, where we're looking to increase the numbers, we're not looking to decrease the numbers. And so this is your time. This is your time to go out and show that there is a need for this. I mean, we're not making this up. Obviously following the rules and regulations that are in place, but this is not the time to ask for us to be scared of something that doesn't exist. It shouldn't be.
Thank you, Rakesh.
No problem.
John, I mean, to add on to this, based on, you know, the past experience, we are getting like 100,000 plus more H-1Bs. What do you think this April 1st? Do you think, you know, it is going to be similar to last 2-3 years or different?
It's been increasing every time, so it's going to go more. I mean, basically, there's not enough, so they're being stacked up. So people are needing more than they did and are adding on, right? So we refile, you know, it's one of the things we'll refile again. We're going to refile all of these people.
It's just
adding. And I wanted to say something that triggered on the micro and macro level.
I think you'll find for the low-hanging fruit.
So on the micro level, every lawyer here is saying file your H-1B.
Absolutely not.
When you ask a question, is there anything in this executive order that targets median staffing companies? I think this leaked executive order that is now is about median staffing. I think all about median staffing companies without saying it. Why I'm saying that is looking at the visas that have been some of these.
Something
these
that's going to
being
be like
used in lieu of H's. There's been issues 80, in the past. 85. L visas, they want to look at L's. They want to look at H's, right? So the one thing isn't to be afraid. Don't be afraid. But you've got to change the questions. You've got to change the story that's being said. There's a concept called a meme. A meme is a theme that gets thrown out there and promoted, right? So the meme that's being said that I keep hearing, it's just a stupid meme because it may happen at one thing, but somebody grabs it and they keep going, is that what's happening is American workers are training H-1B people to take their jobs. That's the meme that's out there. Now, that may happen from time to time, but that's really not the situation. H-1B workers are coming in with a talent level that we don't have enough in America, and they're creating ancillary jobs for Americans that can build companies. That's the story that needs to be told. So instead of being afraid and not filing your H-1Bs, we need to get case studies of people that have been turned away on H-1Bs, like the guy that's in charge of the Amazon of India was turned down for an H-1B, went over there and started that company. That guy wanted to work in America. We need to tell those stories. We need to tell the stories of the American companies that weren't able to hire really good people that they lost. We need to tell the stories of the six-figure American management that had to lose that job because they had to move their entire tech sector out of Silicon Valley or somewhere else to another country. Those are the people that are losing jobs, not the people America had. We're 25th and 27th in science, right? American colleges are the top. In the top 10, we have 8 of them. Only Oxford and Cambridge, which are 6th and 7th in universities, are here. We're importing science. We're importing math and science from India primarily to help mix with our innovation in America to make us the best. And the story's being told incorrectly in this executive order and these bills. And the folks here have to get there and tell these stories to their legislators, and they have to get that story out. That's where it needs to change.
John, to add to that, you know, I mean, when you say the Indian companies, I mean, are you talking about the Indian companies like big Tata's, Infosys,
yes.
And, you know, these
yes.
are, you know, I mean, the small consulting companies. Most
right.
of us in this room, you know,
right.
we file probably less than 50, less than 100.
I know.
Small companies.
But if
we being right. incidental.
Right. But that's not the theme, right? And that's what I'm saying. Don't be afraid to do this, but understand that there is a division in this country right now that's been different before. We're making a drastic change from how Obama's America looked at diversity to Trump's America, looking into little pockets. I think that what we have to be ready for, not to be scared for, is that the Indian staffing company, the Indian technology person, despite being an amazing impact of making our country is in one industry we're great at, is going to be looked at as a negative thing. We have to change that dialogue. We can't just sit back and let them do it. So while you got to file your visas, talk to people about these stories, change this dialogue. This sector needs to be the heroes of yep. what we're doing in America, not the villains. And that's bizarre to me that this is a negative thing, but you can't ignore that there is that theme being perpetrated by certain people that want to shut this down, or I don't know what their vested interest is, but that's what's going on. Thank you.
Guys, I just want to say one thing. Trump executive order has not...
Guys, please be a little bit, you know, I mean, we have Susan here and executive order is in still in existence. Please be silent.
I just want to say something to all of you, employers and employees. Trump has not frozen your lives. So don't let him freeze your life. You move on with what you're doing.
He has not done that.
I know, that's what I'm saying. Trump hasn't done it.
He's freezing the entire country with his Twitter account.
So don't give him the pleasure of freezing your lives. Go about doing what you're doing. Find your H-1s. Make sure you have all your documentation. And if you don't, of course, you can expect RFEs. So don't let him do this. He will have the vicarious pleasure of saying, here it is, I've stopped some brown people from filing. This is exactly probably what he's looking out for. Please don't allow him to do that. Please go ahead, file. And I'm pretty sure, like what some of my colleagues have said, the more you file, the more you're proving that still the H-1B is something that is required for these employers, that you need, you know, highly educated, you know, brainy people coming into the country or hiring them in the United States. So don't stop from doing what you're doing. Now, having said that, you know, H-1 is not the only one. You're not talking of L-1s. Even that is out there. There's no ban on that. As employers, if you have a branch out in any other country, you can always bring your employees on L-1. And you can always bring a B-1 in lieu of an H-1. So all these options are there. Nothing has been taken out by an executive order. So I just want to wrap it up by saying, don't allow anyone to freeze your life. Just go on. There's no law.
Thanks so much.
There's no executive order.
This gives a lot of confidence.
Yes.
I want to end with the last two questions. I mean, there are lots of bills, three bills in Congress right now, and the fourth one is in the draft stage, and it came out today in the news, Indian media actually. It came out in the Indian media before the US media. It says the race. What it says is like they are going to bring the legal immigration by hack. I mean, it is so unfortunate that, you know, I mean, it was not detailed enough. But it is so public.
But I think it's more hitting the...
Who said there's only four bills?
I mean, which are...
I mean, that's wrong. There are about 40 plus immigration bills pending.
Yeah.
And the preceding 10 years, there were about 100 immigration bills introduced. And in the preceding 10 years, not a single major immigration legislation has been passed. Why are we worried about that?
But the one which they talked about today, Cotton's bill, it talks about family-based. It doesn't talk about employment. It talks about restricting only spouses and kids.
The problem again, Kavita, it was not put in that way. This article was in Economic Times yesterday, and it was not given the full details.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, I mean, we got emails from everybody in India first before we heard anybody from here.
It is not even a bill, it's a proposal.
Exactly.
It's a proposed bill from a Republican senator from Arkansas. He's one of the ones who proposed this.
Yes.
But it is only a proposal.
Yep.
It is not even introduced.
I mean,
there's a long way to go. And let me tell you, like Rahul and others were saying, a lot of bills are actually introduced each year, whether it's immigration or whether it's due to transportation or budget. Some of them just die out. They don't even make it. So there's a long, drawn process before they actually get there. There's a Senate a Judiciary Committee. There's a House Judiciary Committee who even discusses these immigration bills before even it gets to the House and the Senate.
Last time, any immigration bill that came closer was the Gang of Eight. That was in 2012. That is five years ago. And it has all the pump. Really, we thought that it's going to be passed. It was really passed in the Senate, too. It passed in the Senate.
I know it passed there, but I didn't think it was going to pass.
It did pass the House. So it was never floored in the House. That means it never became a law. So even after it's passed in the Senate, it was never passed out. So these things, they're not even referred anywhere. There are not even any sponsors for those things. So you're wasting your energy.
So, I mean, we confidently consider that these are not going to be passed.
No.
Well, as confidently I can say that the alien object is not going to hit the earth right now.
Yep. Thank you. That gives a lot of calm as well. I mean, Grace, this is for you. I mean, there is a lot of things are discussing about, you know, I mean, DHS and DOL being hired for 1,000 new employees.
Right.
I mean, what is the thing for the companies like us? And, you know, I mean, what do you suggest on the compliance?
There's a plan, but there was also an executive order that did get issued that says there's a hiring federal freeze right now. So I don't really think he's going to be able, and the only people that they can be hired is for the military. So I don't really see how he's going to hire 1,000 people when he just issued an executive order saying that there's a federal hiring freeze. Right. Secondly, if they hire him, I mean, I think that one is for like, there was talk about it was for cybersecurity, which is not really, you know, I mean, it's more about making sure that e-transactions and stuff, that those type of focuses. Whereas, you know, in terms of fraud investigation, H-1Bs are always under the purview of DOL. I mean, you know, USCIS approves the position, but DOL is the agency that approves it. And in the past audits that I've undergone, the one thing that I've seen from DOL is that they are very understaffed and they are overloaded with cases. And so it may take, you know, so for them to hire more people, that just means that they probably will get more up to date.
Yeah.
And, you know, with the DOL odds I've done in the HTB and the H-1B sections, they're pretty straightforward. And so as long as you're in compliance, as long as you're doing the right thing, it's more of a procedural thing than anything else. It's just basically showing them payroll records and showing them that you're complying with the wages and everything and that you're paying prevailing wage. You know, I mean, most of the time it's just purely a procedural process where we go through all the documentation, show them they're in compliance, and you know, the most that they'll issue, especially if it's the first time, is back wages. On the HTB front, they just usually issue a letter saying, hey, we want to take a look at this. We send it to them, and if they see any issues with it, they'll let us know, but they never really assess penalties or anything like that for first time violations.
Thanks, Grace.
Sure.
I would like to add to that. I saw that question on there, and I received a call a couple of days ago from one of the field officers regarding one of the candidates not on the side and stuff, and I asked them the same question that DHS and Department of Labor is going to hire quite a big number of people, I heard, from the grapevine, and she said, thank goodness they are, because we are so loaded with work right now. If they would, it'll help us, because the delays we have in sending even the notice of receipt, it's really going to help us. I mean, jokes apart, I'm just giving you an example. So she did not even know that that was going to happen. I agree with Grace. It's just in the air. Yeah, there is a federal freeze. It's not going to happen. Even if it happens, it's going to help Department of Labor and DHS. And you guys will be happy receiving the notice of receipt and approvals in time.
Immediately.
Yes, not immediately.
You don't have to file.
You don't have your hopes high. Not immediately, but
you don't have to go for a premium. You know, we save money for our employees.
Well, they make money off of that. That's not going to happen. That's
eight, what I'm saying. 8 months for an H-1B extension.
Yeah.
But the only thing I would say, I'm sorry. The only thing I would say is it's not a bad idea. Actually, it's a very good idea, in my humble opinion, to have all your public access files, your I-9, and the payroll record in place. Let's not take it lightly, because if it hits, it'll be it won't be easy to recover from.
Yeah.
I mean, you brought up the I-9 thing, Sharda. I mean, big question on that. There is a change in the I-9 form recently. Do we have to go and change all the existing I-9s, or is it going to be for only the future
I-9s?
Only future. Okay, thank you. Guys. Yes.
Can I just ask, conclude this?
Oh, yeah.
I don't practice immigration law anymore, maybe just one or two cases when I really charge a lot of money so they don't want me to be a lawyer. But I'm talking from as an outsider because I do work with corporations who are looking to folks like you to be their vendors, right? To be the, and I think I shared with Satish and also Kishore earlier at lunch today that my role as with USPAC is to promote Pan-Asian American businesses. And for some time, because the South Asians have been so IT-oriented. So I know then, 3 years ago, that you have IT on your forehead, okay? And my members who say that they see me walking in, they walk away from me, because they don't want any more South Asian IT companies, because they want to bring diversity to, and when you're going into corporations, they have a mandate, and they also have an idea they want to share the wealth, so they want to make sure that any IT starting a business is spread around to African American, to Hispanic. I see them pushing hard for the business towards a Hispanic woman, make a $1 billion company, because they want to make a success story out of that. Okay. So I know that they have been saying, Susan, we have too many IT companies nowadays, especially South Asia. And that is your disadvantage, the disadvantage of your clients. You are a walking brand for yourself. Capable, competitor, no, we don't want that, we want to give it. It's very similar to the Ivy League college when they say, too many Asian American are in Stanford, in Harvard. We have a cap, we don't want them anymore. To the detriment of the colleges, there's some colleges that are supposed to get the best advisors. So in the IT business, internally, they have that. So I think the idea about this executive order is not really targeting South Asians, Indian. That sentiment has been there long before Trump came into the picture. It's within corporate America. Within corporate America, the Asian Americans are too good. They're too willing to work hard. They're too reasonable. But slowly our price begin to creep up and then normalize something. So I just want to share with you that from my perspective, working with corporations, they say, Susan, we got too many South Asians. In other words, don't send them to us anymore. Do you have something else? So it's not a Trump phenomenon.
It's not, because the problems with the H-1B started during Obama's administration, if you look at it.
Yep.
So why are we not talking about that again?
That's right.
Because Trump is making a loud noise right now that everybody's
exactly.
But all the problems started during Obama's administration. I'm not saying, you know, what we have is very good right now, but we had one side of a spectrum which was very liberal, but at the same time, they were cracking down on this program already. Trump is just picking up at the tail end.
Yep.
So I agree with Susan saying that
probably it is all about the timing, Kavita, and one executive order which created so much drastic impact on the lives of so many people.
Rumors versus facts.
Yes.
That's my favorite word right now.
Created a lot of fear.
Yes.
And Trump loves Indians.
Yes.
He loves Indians.
Oh,
he's friends with him. He has investment in India, so he's no problem with
There has been some fire, and the smoke is what we are getting right now.
Exactly.
So we just have to wait, let the dust settle down. It's going to be okay. That's all I'm going
to do. We need that drum to beat the
good. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. This gives a lot of confidence. The words for us, what I hear is, sleep peacefully. Go on vacation.
Not domestic. Go to Hawaii.
Florida.
Mexico.
Go to Hawaii.
Go to Hawaii. Don't go to Mexico.
Thank you. Thank you.